faculty and participants of this faculty development program. I would like to introduce myself. I am Mrs. Hepzibah Beulah, assistant professor, and I will be your host for today's program. Before we begin the program, I kindly request you all to rise up for the Tamil Thai Vaazhthu.
நீராறும் கடலுடுத்த நிலமடந்தை கெழிலொழுகும் சீராறும் மதனமென நிகழ்வரதர் கண்டனிதில் எக்கணமும் அதில் சிறந்த திராவிடனல் திருநாடும் தக்க சிறு இறை முதலும் தரித்தனரும் திலகமுமே அத்திலக வாசனை போல் அனைத்துலகும் இன்பமுற எத்திசையும் புகழ் மணக்க இருந்த பெரும் தமிழடங்கே தமிழடங்கே உன் சீரிழமை திறம் வியந்து செயல் மறந்து வாழ்த்துதுமே வாழ்த்துதுமே
Thank you. You may be seated now. I welcome you all to the virtual premises of Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupakkam. This is a 130-year-old institution founded in the year 1851. It is the second oldest law college in the country and the first law college in South India. The students from our college include eminent jurists, legal luminaries, national leaders, and heads of various academic institutions. The college has been conducting various online and offline programs for the faculty and the students. From the beginning of this month, we have been conducting webinars on various themes addressing the learning needs of the students and the legal fraternity. The faculty development program is a major milestone in the history of government law colleges in Tamil Nadu, and Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College Pudupakkam has taken a giant leap with the support of our respected Director of Legal Studies and the guidance of our Honorable Vice Chancellor. We are delighted that today we are hosting close to 400 participants from across India. Anyone can steer the ship, but a leader must chart the course. In that way, this entire journey was charted and planned meticulously by our dear Principal Professor Dr. Gauri Ramesh, and I take this as my honor to invite our Principal Madam to deliver the welcome address. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Hepsi. A very pleasant morning to one and all present here. It is an honor and privilege for me to welcome you all on behalf of the Directorate of Legal Studies, Tamil Nadu, and Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupakkam, to this inaugural ceremony of the Faculty Development Program, adorned by leading and expert academicians. At this juncture, I would like to quote the words of Frank Lloyd Wright. I quote, "You have to go wholeheartedly into anything in order to achieve anything worth having," unquote. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome such an achiever who is none other than our chief guest, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. N. S. Santosh Kumar, sir. I wish to extend my deep sense of gratitude to our Vice Chancellor, sir, who was a driving force behind this faculty development program, which is first of its kind among the government law institutions in Tamil Nadu. Our Vice Chancellor, sir, leaves no stone unturned when it comes to the career development of his faculty members. This FTP, which is his brainchild, when he was the Director of Legal Studies last year. However, due to the pandemic, we were unable to proceed further. But this year, with the help of our respected Directorate of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. C. Chokalingam, sir, and my team of dynamic faculties, we were able to roll out this huge event with our Vice Chancellor's wishes and blessings. I welcome you, sir. I would like to quote the words of Albert Einstein. He says, "It is a supreme art of the teacher to awaken joy in creative expression and knowledge. Our chief guest today, Professor Dr. V. Vijayakumar, sir, is well known for his creative methods of teaching. His passion towards teaching and his methods of exploring into different teaching methodologies made him a man of action, and we feel proud that the former Vice Chancellor of our Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University has been awarded the Best Vice Chancellor Award during his career. I thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and wholeheartedly welcome you, sir, to this event. And we thank you for accepting to do the inaugural address. Thank you, sir. Next, I would like to welcome our respected Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. C. Chokalingam, sir. Now, he's our captain who has taken education from the School of Storms. Through every challenge that we faced, our ship sailed smoothly and has reached this great occasion with the guidance and support of none other than our respected director, sir. I would like to proudly place on record that during this month of June alone, we have successfully hosted around 9 national and international webinars, which included the first Tamil Satta Karutarangam, all of which has received overwhelming response from the student and professional community. We wholeheartedly thank you and welcome you, sir, to this program. Better than 1,000 days of diligent study is one day with a great teacher, is a Japanese proverb, which is the foundation for our faculty development program today. We have invited two great teachers for each day who will mentor, stimulate, and engage the students, and that is the legal faculty members, and with their long stint and experience. Now, I thank all the resource persons for their time and participation and welcome them all. With this short note, I welcome all the principals, HODs, and faculties of various law institutions across the nation. I welcome the faculty of Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupakkam, and thank them wholeheartedly for the efforts behind the scenes in conducting this faculty program. Last but not the least, I would like to thank and welcome my co-conveners, Mrs. Devi, Mrs. Hepzibah Beulah, Dr. Shyam Sundar, Mrs. Ramya, Mrs. Ehahini, and Mrs. Kritika for their meticulous hard work. It is indeed a tremendous teamwork, and the college stands for and believes in it. Let us remember the words of a former president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. Teaching is a very noble profession that shapes the character, caliber, and future of an individual. I wish all the participants the best of learning experience throughout this week, and to be the heart of the legal education system in India. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, madam. There is no specific recipe to be a great teacher. Each has a combination of various ingredients. Our respected Director of Legal Studies is a great law teacher with more than 30 years of teaching experience and with special ingredients that make him a great teacher amongst his students. It's now time to felicitate the guests. Therefore, I request our Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. C. Chokalingam, to deliver the felicitation address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Chiba.
Thank you, sir.
A very warm good morning to all the participants. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Santhosh Kumar. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Mr. Vijay Kumar. The well-known speakers of the day. I am always very proud to say I was one of the sincere students of Professor Dr. Gandhi, the present Dean of VIT Law School, and my dear sister Hepzibah, the principal, the very dynamic principal of the reputed Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College. my dear sister Gauri Ramesh, the principals of various law colleges, the backbone of Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudukkottai, the faculty members, teachers, and my dear students. I am really very happy to participate in this August occasion, because I know the hard work behind organizing such a very important faculty development program. That too, in the pandemic period, organizing such an important program for the benefit of the faculty members, not only the faculty members, ultimately the beneficiaries are the students. It will be very difficult. So first of all, I congratulate the Captain Madam Gauri Ramesh for organizing such a wonderful program. And also I congratulate the team behind Madam. Due to paucity of time, I am not mentioning each and every member. There is a famous saying, the poor teacher tells, an average teacher explains, a good teacher demonstrates, a great teacher inspires. Today, our Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudukkottai, has taken an effort to make our teachers a great teacher, being always appreciated by our students. So in this August endeavor, I express my heartfelt felicitations to all the participants, and I wish this program a great success, as all the participants are eagerly awaiting to hear the words of the giants, two honorable vice chancellor. I don't want to take much of my work. So I once again express my felicitation to all the participants, and thank you all for giving me this wonderful opportunity. I wish this program a great success. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your wonderful wishes, sir. Our chief guest for today is the Honorable Vice Chancellor of the Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ambedkar Law University. He has followed the legacy of his father in becoming an able administrator as a principal of Government Law College, Director of Legal Studies, and now the Vice Chancellor of the Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ambedkar Law University. In his tenure, he has been the forerunner in starting 7 new law colleges and recruiting the highest number of close to 130 assistant professors. Leaders don't force people to follow, they invite them on a journey. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor has invited us all on an academic journey to equip and to be equipped. Our institution has achieved many milestones with your guidance. I take this as my privilege and honor to invite our Honorable Vice Chancellor to deliver the presidential address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Hepsi. Honorable Vice Chancellor of National Law University, Bhopal, former Vice Chancellor of Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ambedkar Law University, Chennai, former Registrar and Senior Professor of National Law School of India University, Bangalore, Visiting Professor of York University, Toronto, Canada, more than everything, the best Vice Chancellor awardee, Professor Dr. Vijay Kumar, sir, respected Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. C. Chokkalingam, Dr. Gauri Ramesh, the dynamic principal of Chennai, Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudukkottai. The co-conveners, Ms. Devi, Ms. F.C. Babula, Dr. Shyam Sundar, Dr. Gandhi, the Dean of AT Schools of Law, Dr. Kundaya, the assistant professors of Government Law College, Pudukkottai, principals of different Government Law Colleges, faculty members of Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University and Government Law Colleges and deemed universities, all the participants, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning to one and all. At the outset, I wholeheartedly appreciate Dr. Gauri Ramesh for bringing Professor Dr. Vijay Kumar for this virtual meet, as he is a right choice. To that extent, a right person in the right place, by which we all will get an opportunity to hear his lecture. To be frank, I am an ardent fan of him, and his lectures will always give tremendous impact on every human being who wish to know something in the field of law. His simplicity and soft-spoken nature impresses everyone, which attracts him towards what he tells. Let us all pray to Almighty to give him long life and good health, as he is an asset of his country as a whole. Sir, on behalf of Dr. Ambedkar Law University, I too join with Dr. Gauri Ramesh to welcome you and thank you for coming over here once again. Second time, I appreciate Dr. Gauri Ramesh for her dedication to the institution, her love towards the education, and her humane approach towards each and everyone. As a head of the institution, she does marvelous service to the institution, to the subject of law, and to every human being. Why should she conduct 7 days program? Is it an easy affair during this pandemic period? Why should she fix this subject, emerging trends in legal education, for this FDP program? Why should she choose Dr. Vijay Kumar, a very eminent person, when very many persons are available near to her? That shows her committed service. Let all her qualities continue forever. Ladies and gentlemen, emerging trends in legal education is a topic for this FDP program. Yes, it is a need of the hour. Where we are in legal education, already we have seen that legal education is the crossroads that we were all telling since two to three decades back. Even when I was doing my LLB, it was stated in that way, that legal education is in the crossroads. According to me, due to technological developments and changes in human attitudes, to some extent, some developments we can notice. Yes, the apt person to tell about you in a correct sense would be not myself, our beloved professor Vijay Kumar sir only. Another thing we must notice here is this FDP meant for the teachers. What is the present scenario of your teachers in legal education? According to me, subject to exception, teachers' involvement in legal education is not up to the mark. Please take it easy. If anybody thinks that I do well, in that case, I will comfortably put that gentleman under the exception category. Gentlemen, please note that I don't want to hurt you in any way. Involvement I meant here is their dedication, their hard work, their perception about legal education, their reaction towards legal education, their technical skill, their understanding about the student, their dealing of students, their interaction with outside world, their exposure towards other universities, including foreign universities, their knowledge about international developments, their knowledge in recent developments, their knowledge in judicial interpretations, their knowledge in judicial activism, their knowledge in judicial overactiveness, etc., etc. Unless and until we are good in those areas, we cannot be a good teacher. Theoretical knowledge alone will not shape you, and some practical aspects also will have a say to shape you for declaring you as a good teacher. Let us all concentrate on legal education in the present scenario rather than discussing about the individual. But it is a need of the hour that every teacher should team up, team himself up by joining in these type of APP programs and refresher courses and intermittent joining of different national and international conferences and so on, so on. Then only you will be declared as a good law teacher. Even we are in the dark of having good law teachers nowadays. So I am sure that Dr. Gauri Ramesh's efforts of conducting these type of FDPs will definitely get new hands with new vigor in the field of legal education. Former Professor Dr. Madhava Menon advocated for immediate action to correct the present legal education and emphasize on realization of meaningful legal education. The same way, former Chief Justice Deepak Mishra once stated that it is axiomatic that law is ever changing and ever growing. The dynamic nature of law can only be understood with the help of right and contemporary legal education. Therefore, there is always a heavy onus on the part of the law professors of this country to adapt and grow with the changing needs of the time so as to keep pace with the transformative nature of law. Changes would take place in conference with the needs of the modern world. And he urged the legal academia to the neurophysician to administer thoughtful medicine which would aid students in making choices in their lives. What a fantastic quote. He has categorically stated that legal education plays a very important role and the role of law teacher is really supreme. He tells that the process of law has a bounded duty to reform the legal education by all possible means according to the needs of the society. Then automatically we can come out of this crossroads. If we refer the recommendations of Knowledge Commission, the legal education has to be rigorous and good and meaningful research has to be introduced. Improving writing skills of next generation law students, encouragement of original thinking are strongly be recommended in the Knowledge Commission. The Supreme Court observed through many cases that the need for continuing a well-organized legal education is absolutely essential, reckoning the new trends in the world order to meet every growing challenge. The legal education should be able to meet the ever-growing demands of the society and should be thoroughly equipped to cater to the complexities of the different situations. The FTP program is an important effort to study the recent changes which have taken place in the field of law, society, and also to the legal education. As a world is on the virtual platform, making life innovative, law also will never be an exception to experience the changes and to react innovatively. The event will cover under various sub-themes, giving a vivid idea and innovative response to the problems in law and legal education. Therefore, the main focus of the FTP shall be the deliberation on intricacies of law teaching in general and research in particular, while identifying the gaps and suggesting future reforms there. So there are different parts to be concentrated by this FTP program. Dealing about the intricacies of law and dealing about the research and suggesting the future reforms required to have a fine legal education system in this country. The aims and objectives of the FTP, if we Therefore, to provide an understanding of innovative teaching and learning methods and research in law should be the first one. Second is to acquaint the participants with intricacies of law and legal research. Third one should be to train and develop young academicians and other participants to upgrade their knowledge and skills in teaching and research. Next is to provide an in-depth understanding about the teaching pedagogy. Next is to provide an opportunity to the participants to deliberate and learn about the challenges facing the legal education and research in the present era. Next, if you refer, to assist them to explore the innovative methods of teaching and learning. To assist them to identify the upcoming research areas across the various specializations and fields of research. Even to assist them the quality research work that can be published in reputable journal at the national and international level with the guidance of experts. To assist them to acquire the knowledge from experts which would percolate the students and ultimately benefit them. Even to assist them to appropriate challenges again in the teaching learning methods and research in law and to prepare themselves better for the same. So these are all the main objectives behind conducting an FDP program. If you concentrate all these 10, you can call it as 10 commandments, other format, we can have a very consecutive FDP program if we achieve its objects. Before the 7 days dissection class begins, from Professor Dr. Vijay Kumar on legal education, let me remind you of certain things. The profession of law teacher in modern times attained a distinguished place with the twin profession, that is, one legal profession and another is law teacher. A good law teacher should be best in both. I'm just asking you to keep in your mind, you are in legal profession and you are a law teacher. You should be best in both. That is my first request. Secondly, the legal education has to move from imitation to innovation. Please keep it in mind. Innovative approach is highly essential to become a good law teacher. Third one is the legal education is to remain intellectually stimulating and socially relevant. Next one is the legal education method shift from industrial capitalism to information capitalism. Therefore, knowledge-based economy can be expected. Nextly, proliferation of new and changed courses led to the introduction of varied teaching methods and devices in the field of legal education. Everyone should know that. Nextly, the objectives of the legal education is little different from other disciplines. The beneficiaries would be lawyers who will go to the bar for legal practice. Therefore, they must be equipped with the offensive and defensive skill. That burden lies with the law teacher only. When he was in as a student inside the legal institutions. Nextly, the method of teaching varied, a problem posing method along with the other methods of teaching like role play can be the best suited for legal education. I went about the different methods of law teaching. The same way, technology based teaching is best, which is being compelled by the present scenario, which is very good for legal education also. The last one would be the teaching by audiovisual method is best suited for legal education. So, dear ladies and gentlemen, with this note, let me wish you a very conceptive and innovative session so far you had in your legal profession, your profession of legal education. All the best, and God bless you one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for taking time out of your busy schedule and sharing your wishes. I take this as my honor to welcome our chief guest, Professor Dr. V. Vijayakumar, Honorable Vice Chancellor, National Law Institute, University, Bhopal. He was conferred the Amity Academic Excellence Award during 2011 and the Best Vice Chancellor's Award by the Indian Red Cross Society during 2012. He is a teacher par excellence who has created self-directed learners and is a fountainhead of illuminating ideas. An effective teaching will remain in the human mind forever. And he has inspired many law students by his teaching, and many are here as law faculty in this gathering. It's an absolute honor to welcome Professor Dr. V. Vijayakumar to deliver the inaugural address. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. My dear friend, Dr. Santosh Kumar, the Vice Chancellor of Ambedkar Law University, Professor Chukalingam, the Director of Legal Studies, my friends, Dr. Gandhi, Dr. M.S. Soundarapandian, Dr. Vincent Kamraj. I saw their names and briefly, you know, that's why I'm able to take the names. Don't mistake me for not calling the names of other ones, the principals, Dr. Gauri Ramesh Kondaya, who was formerly in Bhopal and now he has moved out. Teacher participants, ladies and gentlemen. A very good morning to everyone and a special greeting to Hepzibah, who has been coordinating this event, doing very well job, a very good job.
Thank you, sir.
Please keep it up, right? This is what we require as we proceed. This is one among the hallmark of the academic work, right? You're doing exceedingly good. I think you should retain this.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir.
I am proud to be a student of the then Madras Law College. Twice, not once, twice. I joined the college in 72. But within 1 month, I withdrew my candidacy and joined Presidency College to complete my master's degree in political science. And that was guided by my teachers that I should have my master's degree before going to law, which worked wonderfully well for me. And again, I joined Madras Law College in 1975 and completed the course in 78. And immediately joined the Presidency College to teach my favorite subject, Constitutional Law of India, Administrative Law, apart from courses in political science, comparative government, so on and so forth. So I'm basically proud to be an alumnus of the Madras Law College, the Madras University, and privileged to be at Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University. And I hope I continue to be one among the extended family members of Tamil Nadu Ambedkar Law University. That is why whenever anybody calls, I never say no to any call from Tamil Nadu. I sincerely feel that is part of my life because I was born and brought up there, got my education there, and I owe everything to these institutions as I progress in my life. In this inaugural address, as I am going to continue with the first lecture at 11 o'clock onwards on the role of FDP and what law teachers should do and what institutions should do. Now, for the inaugural address, I would like to make a mention about a couple of things which possibly you also know, but I thought I would focus a little and then guide and possibly advise you to keep your guard open so that you could take all these changes as we pass through. Many people in legal education sincerely feel that the new National Education Policy 2020 has removed legal education from its ambit, so it doesn't apply to us. Right? Maybe they are right, and maybe they are wrong, because I had both the opinions. When the Bar Council members called and said, see, the National Education Policy has eliminated legal education, we are going to do everything, I was the first one to protest. I said, no, you don't. And I'll get into that story a little later. The National Education Policies, the objectives are very clear. It is complete overall and re-energizing of higher education system to overcome the existing challenges. What are those existing challenges? I think we have to do research. And I think some of you doing PhD must find out what are the existing challenges in legal education itself. I think it is really worth doing, rather than doing something on constitution, contract law, tort law, family law, right? These are all people who can do it. But you know, if you want to progress meaningfully, I would appreciate that you undertake even a commission study as to what are the challenges that the legal education is facing in general in the country, and in particular in the state of Tamil Nadu, so that we can arrive at some conclusion as to what needs to be done, rather than groping in the dark, right? I think we'll concretely do and move forward in that direction. So therefore, the complete overall and re-energizing of higher education system to overcome the existing challenges is born out of the vision of the National Education Policy 2020. And therefore, legal education is not eliminated from its ambit, right? I'll come to that, why they said it and what they really meant about this. I hope all of you will also remember, I'm a student of constitutional law. Whatever the education policy omits or does, we don't know. We have to wait till the new law comes into picture. And that law, which is going to substitute the University Grants Commission, will be the institution representing entry 66 of list 1. And therefore, it must be all encompassing. And it cannot eliminate either medical education or legal education. That's my observation. I may be wrong, but I feel that somebody should prove me wrong, right? Unless and otherwise they change the constitution, amend the constitution, remove entry 66, right? And create three other verticals, general education 1, legal education, and medical education. Right, till that point of time, I think what I say is, I feel that it is right. The second important aspect in the institutional restructuring of the National Education Policy is very, very important, because they have emphasized on multidisciplinary educational institutions. And I would request all the principals, the director, and the vice chancellor to organize something meaningful, maybe after the third wave of corona goes, right? A physical meeting and a long discussion, elaborate discussion on why we have to focus on multidisciplinary approach, even to the study of law. And therefore, the National Education Policy, when it suggested that all the educational institutions in the country will become multidisciplinary institutions by 2040. So we have only around 19 years to go. And therefore, we need to think at or possibly plan something for the next stage of growth within the state of Tamil Nadu. And possibly, let me tell you, Tamil Nadu has been a wonderful example for establishing the Ambedkar Law University, the first affiliating law university. Tamil Nadu followed it. And third, now Rajasthan has followed it, right? So there is one more in the pipeline. I don't want to name the state, but one more in the pipeline. So they are all taking lead to see that the gap between the so-called national law schools, islands of excellence, and the other legal education institutions, which are operating in one room, environment, that is removed, and everyone is taken together to bring what you call it as the stature and the respect that the legal education deserves, right? And that should be our objective. And keeping these aspects in mind, the higher education institutions must include three broad categories according to this policy. One is multidisciplinary universities, multidisciplinary autonomous colleges. I want Professor Chokalingam and Professor Santosh Kumar to carefully read this part of it. Autonomous colleges, right? It is not simply you establish a law college. In every district, you can have a college which is multidisciplinary. At the same time, please exercise caution, right? So that it doesn't become what you call it as a general educational institution and the importance of legal education is diluted. So my suggestion is make it multidisciplinary, but make it relevant to those areas where law plays a lead role. Law plays a lead role in every aspect of it. For example, if you're talking about public health today in the country, right? Everyone realizes the importance and significance of public health. And the nature, the law, legal institutions, rules and regulations can play, even during pandemic like this, is something significant on which we need to work towards and then ensure that the public policy and the law is rooted towards this public health issue straight away. And to that extent, if you create courses which are connected to law, I think you will be leaders because you have, as an university, a role to play in the development of these law colleges in your state. And therefore, you need to focus a little on multidisciplinary autonomous colleges. And if that is not possible, right? If that is not possible, then only think of the third one, constituent colleges of a university, which you are already one, right? You don't have to do something different. But how to graduate from there to the second level, that is multidisciplinary autonomous colleges, which means you will be degree granting institutions, right? You don't have to go to the university at all. And I think consciously, both the Vice Chancellor, it is my humble request, the Vice Chancellor as well as the Director of Legal Education, choose one institution. I would appreciate if you choose my alma mater, Madras Law College, now it may be called in different name, and give that autonomy, which will be degree granting institution. I think in the next 5 years, you will be doing a yeoman service, and that model will click over a period. It is not that you will get success in every institution and everything that you do. But if you fail to do it, right? I still remember one of the Ethiopian philosopher. I don't remember his name, very funny name. It is foolish to change the world. It is foolish to change the world, but it is criminal not to attempt so. See, what a beautiful statement it is. It is foolish to change the world, but it is criminal not to attempt. And that is what I am trying to tell. Discuss, deliberate, and identify. And my bias is towards Madras Law College. So try to give that autonomy in the next 5 years and see the changes. And possibly I want this disease to be spread to other law colleges and they all become by 2040, right? We don't know whether we'll be alive or not at that particular point of time. If we are alive, I would like to see that multidisciplinary autonomous colleges led by these law colleges, right? That is what you call it as the most important aspect which we need to look at, right? Now, they're also going to phase out the affiliated colleges system, right? So you must be prepared for that, right? And therefore, it is not that totally they will remove it, but I think to the extent possible, they will graduate them to higher level so that the quality of higher education increases. And the third important aspect, there are many features, but I would like to highlight very few in the 20 minutes time allotted to me. So this third important feature I would like to mention is autonomy, right? Once again, my request to the Director of Legal Studies and the Vice Chancellor, allow the independent teachers who would like to, you know, see that their vision is achieved in whatever manner, it is whether realistic or not, give them a chance to try, right? And that is what is meant by autonomy, right? Autonomy is, which means you must have limited control. You must be loved, not feared. If any head of the institution feels that they must be feared, I think that institution will never progress. You must be loved and hated, but you must be loved, right? After loving, they may hate you. But you should never be feared by your behavior, by your words, by your show cause notices. I think these are the things that if you are able to do, the autonomy will come into picture. And that role is assigned to the General Education Council under the new National Education Policy, which will have a detailed framework both for its own governance and for credit transfer. You know, if time permits, maybe on some other occasion, I'll work with Dr. Santosh Kumar. We'll organize something on dissecting the National Education Policy, which will suit the interest of the legal education institutions, particularly in the state of Tamil Nadu, right? I'll be too happy to do it. And I have, I'm also being nominated as a member by the UGC to see that the new National Education Policy is implemented effectively on two aspects, on regulations and governance. So I have done a little bit of work on that. And I thought I will expect everything to be in place as we proceed. Now, what is it that the National Education Policy did for legal education? It speaks about research. It speaks about internationalization. It speaks about autonomy. It speaks about multidisciplinary institutions, teachers' education, reimagining the vocational education, right? Transforming the regulatory system of higher education, so on and so forth. And effective governance and leadership for higher education institution, and also the provisions for implementing them. So if all these things are to be done, legal education institutions are also higher education institutions. So they cannot totally remove the higher education institutions, that is the legal education institutions, out of its ambit. Already I have written one note in the Indian Express newspaper. If you want, I'll share it with every one of you, which very clearly mentions that apart from the four verticals, functional verticals that the new policy proposes, they should also create two subject-based verticals, one for legal education and another for medical education, so that whatever regulations, whatever accreditation they are thinking about, the benefit flows to every sort of higher education institutions rather than removing them from the ambit of these broad-based, what you call it as, the values inculcated in this National Education Policy. Very quickly on two, three points I would like to mention because time is up. Paragraph 18, 3 is what we read and then forget. We don't read the rest of the education policy. So I thought I will also bring to your notice the benefit of the participants here. It says, I am not going to read the entire paragraph, but the first sentence of, first two sentences of this paragraph, 18.3. The first vertical of Higher Education Commission of India will be the National Higher Education Regulatory Council. It will function as a common single point regulator for higher education sector, including teacher education and excluding medical and legal education, right? So because constantly these are the two pressure groups that seems to be working with the higher policy making, institutions that leave us that autonomy, we will do everything and we know what autonomy means. Autonomy not coupled with responsibility is as good as committing suicide, right? So therefore, whether they have maintained that responsibility, I don't think so. Whether it is medical education or legal education, right? The proliferation of the institution, the quality of these professional education, whether it's legal or medical, I don't think I have to get into it. Having discussed this, the same proposal, the National Education Policy, also makes certain contributions in terms of professional education. Right, though it is mentioned with reference to agriculture, engineering, technical, technological, so on and so forth. When you use the term professional, I think it automatically involves and includes legal and medical professions as well. They are not alien to them. So paragraph 20, chapter 20 or part 20 of this National Education Policy speaks about professional education. I would like to very quickly refer to three important paragraphs, which are quite useful, particularly for Tamil Nadu, Ambedkar Law University, and all the law colleges located under its jurisdiction. 20.1 says, preparation of professionals must involve an education in the ethic and importance of public purpose. An education in the discipline and an education for practice. It must centrally involve critical and interdisciplinary thinking, as if law is not, right? I once again read that it must centrally involve critical and interdisciplinary thinking, discussion, debate, research, and innovation. For this to be achieved, professional education should not take place in the isolation of one's specialty, right? And that is what I mentioned, that legal education should not be an island of professionalism. It must also take with it certain other courses, which I think for the time being more focused on legal education, and then slowly diversify it to such an extent that the importance and the significance of legal education institutions are not diminished. Paragraph 22 says, I told you I am going to read only three paragraphs. Professional education thus becomes an integral part of the overall higher education system. Standalone agricultural universities, legal universities, including the national law universities, right? Health science universities, technical universities, and standalone institutions in other fields shall aim to become multidisciplinary institutions offering holistic and multidisciplinary education. All institutions offering either professional or general education will aim to organically evolve into institutions, clusters of offering both seamlessly and in an integrated manner by 2030. So on one side, they said they exclude legal and medical education. In another paragraph, they say, now you have to do all these things, right? They should also transform themselves. And I really don't know why people say that the national education policy possibly will not apply to legal education. And then comes the most important, very pertinent and very relevant to the situation in Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and even in Rajasthan, right? With affiliating university in place, what is it in store for us? I would appreciate if you could carefully read paragraph 20.4. Legal education needs to be competitive globally. Adopting best practices and embracing new technologies for wider access to and timely delivery of justice. Right? So the object is global. But they also brought in local. Philosophy of localism here. At the same time, it must be informed and illuminated with constitutional values of justice, social, economic, and political, and directed towards national reconstruction through instrumentation of democracy, rule of law, and human rights. This is what the national education policy says. They have culled out everything from the preamble and put them in this paragraph. The curricula for legal studies must reflect socio-cultural context along with in an evidence-based manner, right? The history of legal thinking, principles of justice, the practice of jurisprudence, and other related content appropriately and adequately. So who says the national education policy does not speak about legal education, right? And then comes the most important, state institutions offering law education must consider offering bilingual education for future lawyers and judges in English and in the language of the state in which the institution is situated, right? So they have excluded legal education, but they give lots of directions to legal education institutions both to become global players and also to excel within the domestic jurisdiction of the states concerned. And therefore, we need to read this in context and do whatever is possible so that we can put our head in high up in the air and take the privilege of saying that we did follow these practices to bring in the higher quality of higher education. Having said this, let me very quickly to conclude, say this. I read somewhere Jeremy Bentham's observation. The only class of people who can be pardoned for not knowing law are the lawyers. Let us not create such lawyers, right? So Jeremy Bentham, I think I have read his classic French Revolution, Reflections on French Revolution, right? That is the advantage of being a political science man and also teaching law. So we need to look at something different, right? So we need to create the lawyers who are not the violators of law, even in their dreams, right? If I have to use the Hindi phrase, it cannot be achieved, right? It cannot be realized. But I think we have to, if somebody says it cannot be realized, I think therefore we need to start it. Let us fail in the venture, but we need to create those lawyers who will excel in their character, behavior, right? Integrity, honesty, and sincerity, because ultimately it is the people who seek justice in the courts of law. We should not corrupt those institutions by creating such lawyers. And therefore, we need to reorient ourselves. Now, looking at the pandemic, I have three, four concluding propositions. The blended mode of teaching will continue. And what we are now seeing practically, have you ever imagined, right, that ICT-enabled teaching like this will take place? And I think I seriously thank Corona for bringing that transformation, technological transformation, right? In every one of us, right? Even 80-year-old is able to access that, is able to see the video, able to address, right? Maybe here and there they may falter, but I think it has created a new development, a new type of society. One can be located in Tamil Nadu, Bhopal, maybe in Aurangabad, Bombay, right? Or maybe somewhere outside India. In the last meeting I had, it was international conference on mediation. People from more than 56 countries were participating in one platform. So I think that blended mode of teaching will certainly continue. But there is no substitute for physical teaching, right? There is absolutely no substitute. So I'm saying both, right? There is no substitute, because in the classroom, I can just walk in and walk out and ridicule the Supreme Court or the High Court for giving such a bad judgment, which I cannot do it here because everything is being recorded. I'm speaking with lot amount of caution, right? But in a classroom, I think I'm a free man, and that cannot be substituted. But still, wherever it is required, we need to bring in this blended mode of teaching, which will continue for years to come, and possibly the another way of excelling in legal education and multidisciplinary education is to have a blended mode of teaching. And I hope that Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University has a definite role to play in this regard, along with the Directorate of Legal Education, right? Your family is not only the Tamil Nadu Ambedkar Law University. Your family is an extended family, and consisting of all the law colleges, right? They may not consider you as a family member, but still you consider them as, right? And I hope, when I felt that there was not even a computer or a printer in the principal's offices, right? That was the first initiative we took. But now you are compelled to do it, right? And whatever support, whatever training, that you have to do, I would request both my friends, Dr. Santosh Kumar and Dr. Chokalingam, to work together to create this blended atmosphere to continue, right? If one law college brings some expert, let it be made known to other law colleges also, the students who can be benefited. I'm not saying all the 100 students or 200 students will participate. Even if 20 of them are able to attend, I think that is the beginning of your success. And if you bring the right people to interact with you, let me tell you that 20 will become 200 in the next 2 years. And that is how we have to win over the students. And once we contribute significantly, once you tell them through your behavior and your work that you are working for them, I don't see any strike or any sort of conflict between the teacher and taught will be in the campuses. That will be a thing of the past. And that is for, therefore, blended mode of teaching needs to be looked at very positively. And you should write to the government, and the government is now willing to provide every assistance, right? Providing 1 GB bandwidth and rural areas, computers, laptop, monitors, what do you want? Everything is made available. Then comes the faculty development program. Dr. Santosh Kumar made a mention about it in his speech. I don't know, when I was teaching, there was no such faculty development program. There used to be one program organized by bigger universities, right? And I was also a participant when I started teaching in Presidency College. It was on research methodology for 1 month, organized by Annamalai University in 82, right? Afterwards, I think here and there, because the UGC was giving some money, faculty development programs have been taking place. And after a few years, I was very enthusiastic. After a few years, I stopped going because they were all using the name faculty development program. There was no development taking place either in the faculty or in the programs. So I stopped going, stopped teaching, because not even drinking water facility is made available to the participants by some of the leading universities like Calcutta University. It was quite surprising, shocking. So I stopped going there. But now this is, you don't have to give me water. I have my own glass of water here. So, but at least people can come together and exchange their views. You must create an environment. I'll come to that a little later in the second presentation. The third one is research capacities or capabilities of the teachers, PhD scholars, right? And postgraduate students. Right, left, or the center, I think you have to focus a little. If at all you want to create a good band of teachers, you have to focus on creating that LLM students to focus on research. And you have to focus on research, you have to create that awareness. Please do not enroll somebody as a PhD supervisor or supervisor for LLM. They should know the trade very well, right? And I hope you would recall, when I was there as Vice Chancellor in Ambedkar Law University, we have made two sitting judges to resubmit their thesis, right? So we are not afraid of anyone. We are afraid of only one thing, that is bad quality of research, right? And if that is made clear, neither they will not come, right? But if they come, they will exhibit the best quality that they have. And the job of the coordinator, the supervisor, is to improve that quality. And the fourth one, very important, which I could not accomplish, when I read out the paragraph 20.4 about the medium of instruction could also be in local language, vernacular language, we need to create standard Tamil texts. The government of Tamil Nadu has been giving some pittance here and there, 1 lakh or 10 lakhs, which was not even sufficient for anything, right? So there are two things that you have to focus. One is, today the authors are allowing the translation of the books in various languages. I would appreciate if both of you, the Vice Chancellor and the Director, write to the standard books the authors and tell them that you would like to translate that into Tamil, right? They'll be too happy because their book is used. I think already they have done Ratan Lal or some other book, right? But if you ask them to write on their own, let me tell you, it takes ages. It has been a 20 year long plan, not even 5 year long plan. We got around 20 or 25 books published, and I don't have to speak anything about the quality of those books. And they have been written and forgotten even by their own teachers, right? So therefore, writing the book is not important. Updating the book periodically, right? Once in 2 years, is equally important. Otherwise, the student coming for LLM or even passing out of LLM, if you ask them how many amendments have been made to the constitution, he or she would say 75 or 76, right? Why? The book has not been updated and they have not acquired any general knowledge. So therefore, it is an onerous task which I request, right, both of you to consciously look into and do something. I think your services will never be forgotten. I also did something, but Vincent Kamaraj will realize what we did, and so does MS Soundra Pandian. Few books got revised, and that's thereafter nothing has happened, right? So this is one important aspect. The fourth important aspect is ICT enabled environment, which I have already mentioned. I will not elaborate on that. And finally, encourage more student participation to improve the academic environment in the law colleges. Encourage them, right? For us, we are all worried as principals that if I call some good speaker from AIADMK, now DMK is in power. If you call somebody from AIADMK, then you are, cornered. You will be transferred, right? So I don't think we have to follow this. We have to take a permission, necessary approval, and follow it. Knowledge is not the position of any particular political party, right? And therefore, if somebody needs to be brought in, I think take all the prior approvals and then do it. And the only thing is you have to caution them is not to say a word about the party in power. If that is ensured, I think everything will be encouraged, and allow the students to give them little liberty, little responsibility. And I think if you do it, things will change. And finally, the last one, both for Dr. Santosh, the principals, and the director of legal education, please carefully download the UGC's regulation. Capture this immediately. If you want to transform legal education from what we are today, something better, please read this. It is about teaching or making the students enroll in NCC, National Cadet Corps, and for equivalence as an elective course. Can you believe it? As an elective course. So you can't say when you come to final year, you don't have to take these four or five elective courses. You will pass your, B certificate or C certificate, and get opted for judicial services within armed forces, right? All these things are a possibility. Let me tell you, the students will be too happy to have it. And we have to suggest, we have to mold them, take them to the right direction, so that you will be remembered forever, right? With these few words, I once again appreciate the efforts taken by the Ambedkar Law University, my alma mater, and all the principals and all the participants. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you very much, sir. You have given us points to ponder upon in a fatherly tone. It was a pleasure listening to you as always, sir. Now I request our assistant professor, Mrs. Devi J, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Hetsi. Nelson Mandela said, "Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world." On an individual level, Thiruvalluvar has said, "Orumai kan than katra kalvi oruvarku elumayum yema podaitu," which means the learning which a man has acquired in one birth will yield him pleasure during his seven births. Good morning to all. I am honored to have the opportunity to give you a vote of thanks on this special day on behalf of Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupakkam. I would like to thank our honorable chief guest, Professor Dr. V. Vijayakumar, Honorable Vice Chancellor, National Law Institute, University, Bhopal, who, despite his busy schedule, has found time to grace this occasion. I thank you wholeheartedly for accepting the invitation as a chief guest and keynote speaker for today's technical session. I am sure that the participants will learn a lot from your technical session, sir. We are looking forward to your session, sir. I sincerely extend my heartfelt gratitude to you, sir. Once again, I thank you, sir. I would like to thank our honorable chief guest, Professor Dr. N. Santosh Kumar, Honorable Vice Chancellor, the Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University, Chennai, for sparing his valuable time to be with us during this session. We are grateful to have our honorable Vice Chancellor for his words of encouragement in his presidential address. Your able guidance has always encouraged us. I thank you for your kindness, your interest, your hospitality, and your continued support, sir. Thank you once again, sir. I thank most respected beloved Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. C. Chokkalingam, who graced the occasion with his presence and guidance. Thank you, sir, for sharing with your words of wisdom in your felicitation address and for your unwavering support in all our technical efforts. I once again thank you, sir. I would like to thank our most respected principal, Professor Dr. Gauri Ramesh, for her valuable guidance, encouragement, and moral support in making this event a grand success. I'm very grateful to her for giving us an opportunity to organize this event. Thank you, madam. I thank all the distinguished resource persons, Professor Dr. Gandhi, sir, Professor Dr. M.S. Soundra Pandian, sir, Professor Dr. Vincent Kamaraj, sir, Professor Dr. Kondaya, sir, Professor Dr. Sangeeta Laha, and principals from various law colleges, HODs from Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University, who have blessed us with their presence. I would like to thank our organizing team and faculty members of Chennai, Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, Pudupakkam. I finally thank all the wonderful participants who have turned up in such a great numbers from across the nation to make this virtual event success. Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Thank you, madam. We are at the end of the inaugural session. I kindly request the participants to stay back for the first technical session. We hope you will find the program we have lined up for you to be fruitful and engaging. Thank you very much. Now we will be starting the first technical session. I extend my warm wishes to Professor Dr. V. Vijayakumar for accepting our invitation. Presently, he is the Vice Chancellor of National Law Institute, University Bhopal. Sir was formally appointed as the Assistant Professor of Law in 1988.
Madam, you can avoid it. Already you have done it. Let us not waste that time.
Just for the people who have come, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Within 2 minutes, I'll complete, sir. Just a minute. Thank you so much. Okay. Sir was formally appointed as the Assistant Professor of Law in 1988, as Associate Professor in 1992, and Professor of Law in 1997. Prior to joining NLSIU, he was teaching at the Presidency College, Madras. He was also the Registrar of NLSIU between 2005 and 2008. He has also administered the UNHCR Chair on Refugee Law between April 1997 and April 2018. For his awards, he was awarded Ryoshi Sasakawa Young Leaders Fellowship at the Salzburg Seminar in 1993. He was a visiting scholar with York University, Toronto, Canada, at its Center for Refugee Studies during 2000 to 2003, and was exchange visitor at National University of Singapore during 2004 to 2005 under the Asian Law Institute program. He visited USA in 1988 and the International Visitors Program of the USIS, and on the Living Constitution. Representing the law school, he was a member and vice chairperson of the Board of Governors of the Asian Law Institute located in Singapore National University till 2009. He was the vice chancellor of the Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University, Chennai between 2010 and 2013. He was also a member of Karnataka State Higher Education Council between 2012 and 2016. He was chairman undergraduate council between 1997 and 1999 and of the postgraduate council between 2003 and 2005 at National Law School of India University, Bangalore. He has published more than 47 articles in national and international journals and has contributed to a couple of books as well. It is my absolute pleasure to welcome him to enlighten us with his lecture. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah, good morning to everyone. I would like to speak about the importance of FDP, Faculty Development Program, and what should be the general role of a teacher, and in particular, the role of a law teacher. There is a vast difference between the general teacher, right, of any other subject, any other professional course, but particularly law, for the simple reason that law keeps on changing. in science, engineering, and other things, they also change, but it takes some time. But law is something different, and that is why when I addressed to somebody, they asked me, can you give a topic? I said, I would like to give a topic, because many new teachers in law, when I interacted with them, maybe your experiences are different. I asked them, what subject would you like to teach? They will mention the jurisprudence, or they would mention administrative law. And to be very frank with you, in spite of my master's degree in political science, public administration, and in law, I hate to go to jurisprudence class, right? Because it requires not only thorough reading, mastery over the subject, which I feel I don't possess. But the youngsters who are coming, straight away they said, I can teach jurisprudence. I appreciate their courage and conviction, but I don't know how will they fare in the classroom, right? That is one point which we need to remember. Second point that we need to remember is administrative law. Let me tell you, that is what distinguishes the law teacher from other teachers. It is not simply the change of law. It is the change of rules, regulations, notifications, and orders issued by various departments from time to time. By the time you pick up one rule, go to the court and argue, the other lawyer will come out with the latest order and say that has been already removed from the book, statute book. So therefore, the role of a teacher, particularly in law, is constantly update the information. And today the climate is very, very conducive. Earlier, we need to wait for the current central legislation, that book to come to the library, and the librarian must be present to access it. Then only he will give it to us for reading. By the time 3 or 4 months would be gone. But today it is not so. The moment the order is posted on the website of any particular department, I can straight away download, use it, right? So ease of mastering the facts is available today, and therefore teaching of these courses, the teacher should be always updating one's knowledge with the latest information, right? Not every week or every month, but possibly every day. Then only that makes, that is the role that the teacher has to keep in mind, right? Now, I have been using this logic to impress upon the teachers that way back in 1987, somebody went to the dean of Harvard Law School and asked him the question, Professor, please tell us, why is Harvard Law School is always on the top, year after year? What is the secret? He said, there is no secret in it. He said, there are three important characteristics or features of legal education at Harvard. And he was narrating those three. What were they? The first one, he said, was mastery of basic knowledge in various areas of subject, right? Core courses. And luckily for us, the Bar Council has decided what the 24 courses are. So you should have basic knowledge of those 20 subjects at least, right? That is the start off point. The second one is enhancing communication skill. A student as well as a teacher, right? Let me tell you, when I used to be the student at Madras Law College, in the afternoon I used to go to the High Court, and particularly a few benches where Justice Mohan would sit, right? Some important, judges who would sit, who would make the life miserable for the lawyers. And there are lawyers who could also face these judges, right? It is because of their command over the language and the command over the subject matter. Justice Mohan, who was also my senior, super senior, both in Presidency College Madras and Madras Law College, right? And he was a wonderful man in his communication skill and also the subject expertise. Apart from communication skill, his skill he is also bilingual. He can speak so effectively in English and so fluently in Tamil as well, right? So it is not the language that matters. You can master. I was told that Narasimha Rao used to speak in 14 different languages, right? You must have love towards mother tongue, no doubt about it. But please do not see that you should not learn any other language. I can speak 4 languages. I also try to learn French for about 2.5 years, but I have forgotten because nobody speaks in French, right? Sometimes when teachers speak, it looks like French, but right? So therefore, we must be very clear in communication skill. It is the student as well as the teacher communication skill, which involves not only the ability to speak, but also the ability to write. Because when we produce lawyers, there are some lawyers who are very good in writing, articulation, wonderful. But when they go and stand before the court, they use typewriters, right? That that sir, this sir, your lordship, this lordship, that more lordship will come rather than subject matter, because they cannot speak. So a good lawyer must have a harmonious blend of both types of communication, written as well as oral. For writing it, there's somewhat research is required, knowledge where to find the law, how to collect those law and present it orally to a judge. And the same thing applies to a teacher, to do the research before the class and going and delivering the subject matter in a language that is understandable by a vast majority of the students. Not every one of them, because in any class, it is not possible to reach out to 100% of the students. There are still, say, 5 to 10% who would not like to listen to you at all, however good you are. And however bad you are, they are not worried about it. However good you are, they are not willing to listen to, but that is the place where the teacher has to focus, right? I'll come to the knack of doing things as I proceed. So these are the two things, not in the order of merit. What he mentioned as the first one, I'm putting it as the third one. And the third one he mentioned was cultivating critical thinking. Cultivating critical thinking among the students, right? Diametrically opposed views you have to throw, right? For example, if you say the hot topic is about reservation, the economically weaker section, you don't have to take sides. You ask the students, do you think it is good? Do you think it is bad? Right? Make them think. They may be the beneficiaries, they may be opposed to it, but still when you ask them to speak about it, they come out with more and more information and you get those students involved in your teaching, right? And there develops what we call it as that critical thinking, critical mass. It is good, let me tell you, I always used to appreciate the students in the law school, Bangalore. Every time, you know, we used to go start our constitutional law in the third trimester of the first year, right? And I tell them with the opening statement, that I should be grateful to your senior students because they made our life miserable by asking questions, by forcing us to read, by forcing us to balance our views, right? And therefore, we are refined products when I stand before you, right? And I expect the same support from you. So you push the onus on them. You come prepared and you will see that in my class, in the Bangalore Law School, not even a single student will come to the class without the bare text of the Indian Constitution. Because if I find one or two without the text of the Constitution, even among 80 students, I can easily identify who is not, you know, has brought the book into the classroom. I ask them to read one provision. And when they borrow the book from the neighbor, then I tell them very politely, not in any harsh manner, what happened to your book? Do you think that it is not an essential tool for you to understand, right? I make them feel bad and the next time you will see, they bring the book and sometimes they leave the book in the classroom itself so that they don't forget it. But let me tell you, this tool is very, very important. That also gives us some rest in between. When somebody is reading a provision, you take a break, right? Preserve your vocal cord for the next few minutes of your class. So therefore, cultivation of critical thinking or analytical skill that will lead to innovative approach to the problems that we face, right? And therefore, you must be respectful of the court's decision, but at the same time, point out the mistakes which you feel the court has ignored or forgotten, or the court was wrong in deciding a particular case. And then only you will understand that the students will appreciate your views. If you simply say the court said it and therefore you follow it, it lacks logic, it lacks reason. What is your reason? And that is why in the US, the 9 judges in black, the 9 men in black, now men also includes women there. There are women, this is an old statement, 9 men in black, right? Who always thought white, that's what they used to say, right? But now there is mixture of race, color, gender, everything. So I can't use that adage, but I think these 9 judges of the Supreme Court, Federal Supreme Court, eagerly wait for a journal published by the law students of the Harvard Law School. Why? Because the judgments they deliver very few judgments, not like the India Supreme Court, right? Indian Supreme Court has too many. They, all the 9 judges decide each and every case. Here we have benches, a division, right? A constitution and larger constitution, larger benches, so on and so forth. They keep on overruling one over the other. But there, when they deliver the judgments, I was told they decide somewhere around 800 to 1,000 cases a year, right? So therefore, it is easy for them to manage. I can't ask my students to review the judgments of the Supreme Court and write something because we have to publish periodicals every day, right? But there, they were able to do that. And all the 9 judges, the moment the book is released, the volume is released, they eagerly go through the title, find out whether their judgment is taken up for dissection. And if somebody has appreciated it, they go through that. It is not out of anger. It is out of the willingness to learn. They are judges of the highest court, but still they have not forgotten their willingness to learn. And if the students have given some right reason, or the writers or the authors in that journal give some good reason why they consider that the court was wrong in it, they revise their judgment, right? And when Bush went to the court seeking the election as valid election, right? Of course, then the Supreme Court was filled with Republican judges and he got a Republican judgment, right? But this time, when Trump also did the same thing, he packed the court. There was a majority of the judges in the court, but the Republican judges did not think Republican anymore, right? And these advantages of the criticism made by the students in the journal about the judgment delivered earlier was taken into consideration, and they refused to accept any sort of jurisdiction. And therefore, this critical thinking comes out of dissecting without any bias. If the court has done a wonderful judgment, given a judgment, I always appreciate the court for using Article 21 to broaden the rights and liberties of the individuals in this country. I appreciate it. But with reference to federalism, with reference to other concepts, I don't spare the Supreme Court and the judges. I question them. I take them to the constitutional provisions, and I make the students understand that it is not my mistake, it is the mistake of the judges for not having referred to these provisions. That is what is called as core critical thinking. So if all these 3 things are present, that is the success of the Harvard Law School, right? Now, at least the 3 points that the dean had given in 1986 or 87, I think even in 2021, they are totally relevant, right? And therefore, the teachers will keep in mind when they enter into the class. Let me tell you, with more than 42 years of teaching, right? I won't call it as 42 years of rich teaching experience. 42 years I survived, right? Every time I get into the class, I used to be a little nervous, right? And that nervousness will go when I complete the attendance in 2 minutes, right? And the speed in which I complete the attendance, you know, people also appreciate at times. I take one page from this number to this number. Is there anyone absent? No, because you de-emphasize on the attendance, right? And the students also evaluate you. Oh my God, this teacher has taken only 2 minutes and I should be getting into the class within 2 minutes, otherwise I will not get that. That's number one. Number two, they will also compare with other teachers, right? I have seen in many places, I was also one of the victims of such teachers in the classroom when I was a student, right? In law college, we used to have 100, 120 students in a batch, in a classroom, right? And I still remember my number, or roll number was 404, right? And this was in the new building. I should not be saying this, but I need to tell you, right? What I was and what, why I did it, right? And 404, yes, sir. Yes will be inside the class, sir will be from outside the class. I used to run to the canteen where the table tennis board was kept. And 3 years, let me tell you, I just picked up table tennis very well. Right? I continued to play very well, even among the faculty, staff. In Ambedkar Law University also, we tried that. Now, not every teacher was like that. There were teachers, I don't want to once again name them, even if they called us donkeys and monkeys, and that in the Madras Law College at that particular point of time, right? We all kept quiet because the teacher was able to deliver the goods. Now you see the two different examples I gave you, right? And then the teacher, after taking the attendance, you will see there'll be 4 sincere students sitting in the first bench, right? The teacher will say, why are you sitting here? You also go so that I can go back to my room, right? That is also teaching. And the other teacher who scolds left, right, and the center, but we sit quiet. Sometimes the classroom will be filled with students. Some of them used to stand at the back and listen to the lectures for 2 consecutive hours, right? Imagine. And that is what we need. We need to create such atmosphere. That is the first level. Second level is when the teacher is haunted after the class is over, then you are doing some work. When you are haunted, the students must come to you and say, sir, you mentioned this. I'm not able to understand. I don't agree with you. I agree with the court more. They come and fight with you after the class is over in your room. I think then you are really doing something better, right? They will come and fight with you. It is for you too good because you also correct your mistakes. And when you correct your mistakes, go back to the class and tell the whole audience, I'm sorry, I was in a different, yardstick altogether. I stand corrected with the, inputs given by so-and-so in the classroom, and do it once and you will see that your respect in the classroom goes sky high in no time. Because a teacher who is willing to accept his or her mistake is what the students appreciate. Don't think that the teacher knows everything and the teacher need not know everything. And particularly in law, they need not. Even the Chief Justice of India said that he doesn't know many things. We need not laugh at it because that is the growth in which law has progressed. For a human mind to keep track of everything is very, very difficult. And therefore, the qualities of teaching as you progress, that will bring the critical thinking. So these 3 aspects, once again, I recollect very quickly. Mastery over the basic or the core courses. Communication skill, both written and the ability to speak. And finally, cultivation of critical thinking. These are the 3 trade secrets of Harvard Law School. If we also want to become, right? Not the Harvard School per se, because it will take years together, but somewhat better than what we are today, then you are moving ahead. A small change will lead to greater revolution in the years to come. So that change has to come from the teachers. And if you're able to do that, the students will change. And therefore, the Harvard Law School is what it is even today, every year being ranked as the top law school in the country and in the world. I would like to add 2 things more, because what he said was in 1986-87. But I would like to add 2 more things. Ability to use information and communication technology by the teachers and by the students, right? I'm using the phrase ability, not mastery, right? You don't have to become a software programmer. That's not what is intended. But you should know how to use, the PowerPoint presentations, how to make PowerPoint presentation. One should not make and give you. And while reading, if the power goes, the point also goes, right? And the teacher will be just looking pathetically before in front of the students, which should not happen. So you should master. You have to allow the ICT technology only as your servant. The moment this, please carefully listen to me what I'm saying. The moment the teacher thinks ICT is the art of teaching, ICT is everything. Whom I call them as pen drive teachers, right? Anytime you tell them, they bring the pen drive, put it in the computer and open that PowerPoint presentation, read out from top to bottom. What is it that they have added? Anything? Maybe some words here and there, but it is nothing but what is already printed in the PowerPoint slides. Then the students also understand. That is why I said, when in many occasions, because we don't have 24/7 constant flow of electricity, right? And therefore, when the power goes and before the generator starts, right? Then I think we have to look at the students, and some teachers are too smart. I also, carry. Please take a challenge. If you want to go to the class, send the PowerPoint presentation to the students first. Don't show it in the class. Send it to them first, right? Out of 100 students in your class, maybe 20 will read, 80 may not read. 60 will follow you in the class. 20 may not either read or follow, whatever you say. Your job is to convert that 60 students who do not read your PowerPoint presentation to come to the class. At the end of the semester, if you are able to prove that all the 80 will read and come, forget about the 20. 20 you cannot change, right? Even if you want to, when their parents cannot change them, what can we do, right? But let me tell you, even the 20 will change, because he will tell his juniors, be careful with this teacher, right? The teacher is good, very harsh, disciplinarian. If you follow, you can learn something. Even the 20 will tell you, tell the junior students. So therefore, you must be conscious. You master ICT. Don't allow ICT to become your master, right? I always tell this as an anecdote to the teachers. I'm also basically a sports person. There is an event called as hammer throw, right? Hammer throw is that there is a brass ball or iron ball connected to a chain or a wire, 1 meter long, and there will be a handle. You are supposed to rotate it around yourselves and release it. And release it in that 45 degree, right? That is why if you see the event, in many sports field, it is covered with net, metal mesh, so that it doesn't go to the other audience or the, people waiting outside to see you. Now, this is 22 pounds, right? That 22 pounds, you have to rotate it 3 times or 4 times. That is the velocity that you get, maximum speed that you gain. And then you should release it. You must be ready to release it. After that 3 revolutions, you are not able to release it. Let me tell you, the 22 pounds will take care of you. It will keep rotating you and you do not know when to release it, right? And then if you try to release it, if you don't release it and stop suddenly, it will come rotate around you and it may even kill you instantaneously, because 22 pounds of that metal ball, if it hurts, anybody, any part of the body, I think anyone, no one can survive, right? So therefore, ICT is also like that. You should know how to use it, how to release it, and save yourselves and also be successful, right? So please carefully listen to this. ICT should be at best your servant. The moment you allow it to become your master, you are no more a teacher, right? And sometimes I always give this example. In the 1980s, in Western universities, they had this, what you call it as, it has started in London, the tape recorder culture, right? The student will attend the class. If the student is bored, like what I did, I learned table tennis, but this fellow will keep the tape recorder and he will get that 60-minute cassette, right? Switch it on, record it and go. The tape recorder will be on the chair. The teacher will come and shout, right? The tape recorder will record itself. He will come if at all he wants to play back and see, he will do it. Otherwise, he may not. On one occasion, the teacher came to the class. He saw all the benches empty, but all the benches were occupied by the tape recorders. So culturally, the teacher has to evolve himself. So next day, he also recorded his lecture, brought the tape recorder, switched it on and left. After 5 years, when the student went for some placement, a law firm asked about the qualities of this candidate. Then the student also realized, the teacher also realized that they have not come face to face. And the teacher politely refused that I cannot write a recommendation for him, nor support, because I do not know the candidate. I have not met him. And the same thing happened scientifically, technologically improved in the 90s in Australia. It is not mandatory for you to attend the classes. But every class, videograph is recorded. Video is recorded, audio video is recorded. And after the class is over, the teacher has the obligation to remove the cassette, write his name and the subject, the date, keep it in the library and go. So the students who could not attend, possibly if they have the interest, will go to the library and see it. And here also the same thing happened after a few years, when some recommendation was to be written by the teacher did not know anyone, right? So that disparity will automatically be there. We need to have the ICT used at best as our servant and never allow this to overtake us. And finally, particularly in the context of Tamil Nadu, I will modify a little. I do it like this. Learning a foreign language is very, very important, right? I refer to the national education policy. Globalization is the vision. If you have to globalize our higher education, learning a foreign language is equally important. And let me tell you, year before last, when I came here, there was not even a single foreign student. I canvassed effectively, got approval for recruiting foreign students. Right? Last year, we got 6 applications, out of which we took only 2, 1 PhD and 1 LLM. And last week, I received applications. There were 78 applications. Can you believe? 78 applications. And if you do something important, something consistent, the students are willing to come to you. And when they come here, we have to understand their culture, their language, respect their language. And if you learn a foreign language, you are able to practice in a globalized world in at least 2 or more jurisdictions. Right? Let me tell you, the Global Council for the World Bank is a product of National Law School, Bangalore, Vikram Raghavan. His father sometimes calls to find out, at least not only his father, there are also a couple of other people. Sir, why don't you tell him to get married? Because he is always busy doing some work. Because, when you are involved in your work, social obligations do not come to your mind. And when you cross 40, 42, then you are not even willing to marry. Right? So therefore, this is also something that we need to check. Right? Foreign language, there was Justice Bopanna's son, right? Karnataka High Court, not the present Bopanna, the previous Bopanna. He had studied everything in Japanese, right? And when he completed his law, he was the most wanted lawyer in Japan, not in India. And all the shipbuilding agencies, companies, wanted him and appointed him as a consultant, right? And he used to come once in a year and he stopped coming to India. His father met sometime later and said, sir, why don't you tell him to get married? The point I'm trying to tell is, one foreign language made him to practice in more than 2 jurisdictions, and they are minting money like anything, right? So therefore, learning a foreign language in a globalized world is very, very important. And in the context of Tamil Nadu, learning English, it is not a sin, it is not a crime. Learn everything in Tamil. To be very frank with you, my BA degree from Presidency College was only through Tamil medium, right? I am not hesitant in saying this. Learning in your own, my mother tongue was Kannada, in fact, but still I studied in Tamil medium, right? I can't read and write Kannada because I was born and brought up in Tamil Nadu. So therefore, learning a foreign language is an asset. Learning some other language, I'm not saying you have to learn Hindi or Kannada, but at least the link language, English, must be consciously promoted in your teachings, right? Let me tell you, Vincent Kamraj is also present here. He was the controller of examinations. And we found more than lack of scripts will come in English language. And we used to find that even to evaluate, we don't have the teachers. That used to take lots of time in evaluating English scripts, English paper 1 and 2, right? Today, let me tell you, if any principal is interested, can ask the students to subscribe to one particular channel, which trains all the students to speak from Tamil to English in 30 days. You only help them, you only guide them. Even you don't have to buy these software. They are all available free of cost. There are social media. There are many more things. Create that avenue. Tell them, right? And when you do it, that communication skill, let me tell you, will take not only the teachers, but also the taught to a greater extent. I was reading with keen interest. I've been a frequent traveler. I've been going to different places in India and visited more than 40 countries. In the aircrafts, they used to give a magazine. You know, I also read some of the nice articles written by them. And on one such occasion, I was able to read Jet Airways, that magazine, contained a nice article in 2018. This article was written by Karan Gupta, just 4 pages. Right, I have Xeroxed it. I got a copy, right? Got it Xeroxed. I would like to just give you some samples of what this Karan Gupta wanted education, higher education to be in this 21st century. He proposed 3 pillars of higher education. Karan Gupta proposed 3 pillars of higher education. One is digitization, right? Digitization. What it means, I think it may require 1 full hour. I will not get into it. In whatever way we understand digitization. Second one is internationalization, right? Internationalization. Third one is collaboration, right? Third one is collaboration. And then they say, right, these 3 pillars of higher education are turning out to be the game changers in the educational space in India. They become the game changers in the educational field in India. See, what a beautiful way of saying. Digitization, and the second one is internationalization, and the third one is collaboration. They have made game, they are the game changers in the educational space in India, right? They are game changers, you know, if it is, you know, Baiju's, right? I think everyone's aware of Baiju. Today, somebody is purchasing that for $1 billion. Can you believe it? What started as a tutorial, they integrated digitization so very well, right? Today, many of the mathematics classes for students in US, Canada, Australia are taught by teachers from India through online medium. English for Chinese, Koreans, Taiwanese, Hong Kong, Thailand, they're all taught from India. Can you believe it? Right, using this medium. So therefore, these to be the game changers in the educational space of India. These 3, once again, pillars bring twofold effect. What are they? Number one, bringing affordable education to a much larger audience, right? If it is an FDP, the UGC says not more than 40, right? Today, if you see the number, there are about 235 people, 6 times more. Virtual mode, of course, no doubt about it. But the benefit is able to reach many of you without leaving your place, without leaving your room. You are able to get the benefits of the inputs given by the resource person in the FDPs. So it is able to reach to a much larger audience. And number two, allowing collaboration between universities and countries, thus sharing the best practices in education management, right? Now, let me tell you, I'll put it this way. one visitor to the National Law University Bhopal some 20 years ago. She was teaching in India, went to New Zealand, became a citizen there. Her name is Alpana, and she has become a dean of Waikato University in New Zealand. And she sent a mail to me last year, recollecting her association with NLIU Bhopal, and she wanted the MOU to be developed with NLIU Bhopal. I immediately appreciated her efforts, initiative, and wrote back. I am also the president of the Consortium of Law Schools. There are 22 statutory law schools in this country. Would you consider entering into an MOU with all these 22 universities? And quick came the reply, right, we'll be too happy to do it. Right? Now, they also realized that there are 22 statutory law schools in this country, and they are willing to, they have sent a draft MOU, and I'm going to, you know, send it to each and every law school for what you call it as going internationalization. If you get 10 students from there, you can also send 10 students from here. When I was in Singapore National Law University as a visiting scholar, exchange visitor, and I could see that there was a class every year consisting of 60 students. And all the 60 students were from abroad, not even a single Singapore national in that batch. It is exclusively summer program for international students. They find it easy to travel to Singapore, see the cultural changes that are taking place, right, in this area, and after 1 month they go back. And you see that, my God, and they create the network, and whenever you go to their country, just they give them a call or give them an email, they come and take you around. I think this networking is global now. And that is why we have to understand this collaboration, the significance of collaboration. Illana Tamil la solluvanga parunga gundu sattikulla kudra odite irukku, right? Nama vandu veliya theriyanu appadinaaka we have to be little outward looking. Now he gave the example of Coursera, edX, Udacity, and other platforms which were making money through these online courses. And today we have WebEx, Zoom, Google Meet, so on and so forth, which provide you the facility, right? Though they don't give education, they give you the structure, the IT infrastructure for us to do this. Therefore, if you look at it, Harvard University even today is offering courses, including alternate dispute resolution. World Mediation Congress uses mediation courses. These are the courses, 2 weeks courses, 2 months courses. They charge very heavily, $1,500, $2,000. They make huge amounts of money. The same serious business takes place, right? So it is also money-making business in one sense. So that is why Coursera, edX, and other things have slowly become multi-billion dollar holding institutions by themselves. Collaboration among universities has replaced competition. See the beauty of this gentleman, Karan Gupta, must be an educationist. And he says, collaboration among universities has replaced competition. I'm not competing with other law schools. I'm not saying which law school is better, which is bad. But if I have the element of collaboration, if competitiveness is there, I would not have sent this Waikato University appeal to others. Right? I want every law school to get the benefit in whatever way they want to be benefited. So therefore, collaboration can bring in and it replaces the competition, right? Therefore, your networking, your ability, your net worth, everything increases. And then he says, world is now an open classroom and one can get an international education without even leaving the room, right? You please also tell your students to go to WIPO website. Even also there are number of web portals. You can enroll in that course for 15 days or 20 days. You complete the course, there are a few objective course, you know, questions. You fill it up and at the fag end, you can also print the certificate, right? It is free of cost. So lot many institutions, so you force the students, tell them that there is such an information and possibly students will, at least out of 80 or 100, 20% or 30% will start looking at it and rest of them will follow over a period of time, right? There are many other factors. I will not get into the details of that. I'll now move on slightly on a different note, having said about the dean of Harvard Law School and the article that I read out from the book, Jet Wings, written by Karan Gupta. I would like to ask a question. I don't expect an answer from you, because seeking an answer from all of you will be not appropriate at this platform, on this platform. But please ask this question: what are the essential qualities of a good teacher? What are the essential qualities of a good teacher? Right? Can you think what these qualities are? And then find out whether you possess those good qualities or not. Right? It's very easy for you to say, yes, this is good, this is good, this is good. But introspect and find out how many of these parameters you possess. And then ask the question why you don't possess this, though totally absent or somewhat present, how to improve that. And then possibly you will see a change in yourself when you progress into the teaching. Right? And that is how, as my predecessor speakers mentioned, Chokalingam, if I remember right, that the true teacher inspires finally. Right? The real teacher inspires. That's the last stage. Right? And that is how the purpose of FDP is not to translate what I know in the subject matter to you. That every teacher can do it on his or her own. But I need to tell and expose the teacher to the nuances of the art of teaching and the science of retaining it. The art of teaching and the science of retaining it. Thereby, we create a new level of teaching qualities, right? And therefore, please ask this question, right? What are the good qualities? Maybe if you ask Google Baba, right, what are the good qualities, the Google also will give you a number of parameters. And think and check whether you possess these qualities or not, and find out. And it is an introspection which every teacher must undertake every year, right, for their own improvement and betterment. I would like to focus a little on the role of a teacher, role of a law teacher particularly. Please carefully listen to me. I will take you through these 10 different propositions, right? And if time permits, I will finally take you to what is this academic environment. What I mean by academic environment, I'll make a mention about it. The role of a law teacher, in my opinion, is that the teacher is a tutor, a friend, an advisor, a counselor, a facilitator, an inspirer, a disciplinarian, a learner, a role model to the students, right? All these things will contribute to understand the role of a law teacher in the 21st century. I said that you must also be a counselor, right? In that will bridge the gap between the teacher and the taught. Sometimes give some time to the students. In law school, Bangalore, you know, when they come there, they fall in love with each other sometimes. And the speed in which they fall in love, the speed in which they also break. And when they break from each other, then both of them become, psychologically upset, and a problem begins. So they have secured 98% in plus two, and they fail to pass even some of the courses, you know, as the examination comes. So as a teacher, you find out why somebody is failing. A good student, now everyone coming into all the law colleges, they also come through merit. It is not that we keep the doors open to admit everyone. We don't do that, right? And if somebody is behaving in a different manner, you have to find out why they are behaving it. And when they come and speak to you, give them your shoulders for them to cry. Tell them what is right and wrong, right? And let me tell you, my students from law school, even today, they are all settled in different parts of the world, right? They keep communicating with me in some form or the other. right? And why? Not because I was a teacher, but because I was also a good counselor, telling them what is right and wrong. I used to play football with them. I used to play tennis with them. I used to play table tennis with them, right? But I used to be very close to them. But inside the classroom, I maintained a very, very safe distance. I never allowed anyone to sit on my head, right? It is an art which you have to inculcate this far and no further. In spite of all these things, the students will say, if you go to VVK, that is how I was called in the law school, you go to him, you will not get even a quarter mark extra than what he has given. Right? Unless otherwise, there is a total error, which seldom happens when I do it. Right? So therefore, that goes around, and then that I think counseling is also an important role. It is not that you are paid only for teaching. Your job is to reduce the gap between the teacher and the taught, which will go to contribute to the academic environment in the campus that you live in. Right? That is the first proposition I would like to mention. So once again, I repeat, the role of a law teacher is a tutor, not simply a teacher. A tutor means when somebody comes after the class is over, sir, I didn't understand. Hey, what I have a time, Naliki never comes, right? Please take that 1 or 2 minutes, explain to him in whatever language he understands. He will develop respect for you, right? And that is what I meant. A teacher is also a tutor, a friend, an advisor, a counselor, a facilitator, an inspirer, a disciplinarian, a learner. Don't give the impression to the teacher that you know everything, right? If something is brought to your knowledge, you thank, acknowledge and thank the student for bringing a new knowledge, new piece of information, right? You are also a learner and a role model for the students. Let me tell you, in a class, not every teacher is popular, right? M.S. Soundra Pandian has his own characteristic, right? The teachers and the students respected him because the way that he used to dress in the campus, right? I think Vincent will also agree with me. So the way that he dresses, the way he interacts with the students and the staff, right? You command respect by your own behavior, right? And every student looks at you as a role model. Not every teacher is a role model for everyone, right? Some good-looking teacher may be a large many students, right? But somewhat good teacher, again, a large majority of students. Some teacher will always be a role model for someone at least. I don't think I have come across a teacher who is never referred to as a role model by at least one of them, right? So therefore, you have to increase that clan. How you will do it is an onus on you, right? And therefore, that is the first proposition I would like to mention. Second, access to legal and interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary, and even transdisciplinary information or material, right? For example, if you are going to discuss something about privacy, right? And privacy over social media or internet or whatever it is. Now, you have to understand the technology equally. Understand the policy and understand the law. Integrate them, right? And how to manage it. Management science also comes into picture. Today, in the pandemic in which we are living, right? Public health concern. It is speaking about a law which you seldom teach, right? The law made in 2005, under which all these actions are taken by the government of India. What is that law? I hope everyone knows that, right? Disaster Management Act, right? Under which every action is being done. And the policy, the role played by the state governments, how even an officer, an IAS officer is penalized for not following these, because it is an emergency. So policy, law, medicine, right? Waste management, I think you keep on elaborating, I think almost every aspect falls into it. So you have to understand holistically any topic, you should possess interdisciplinary at least to start with, multidisciplinary as you proceed, and a transdisciplinary approach. And that will make your understanding perfect. Right? That is the second one. And what do you do in that? Marshalling the information regime, which you have, critical thinking that you possess, an amalgamation of these two, when you give it to students, they will be the best of the beneficiaries, right? How do you get this information? Through books, journals, periodicals, case reports, current central legislation, which I mentioned to you, the Supreme Court judgment, and I have 4 or 5 websites which I'll share it with you, right? Which you can virtually show it to the students if you have the facility on campus. The third aspect which I would like to mention is what I borrowed from the Harvard dean that I referred to. Critical thinking as an essential ingredient of legal education. Challenge every existing law. Question every existing law. Question the judgment delivered. Question the rule or regulation made with an intention to understand it perfectly. Not with an interest to roll, bulldoze everything, no. To understand everything in its complexities. And that critical thinking is possible both for the teachers as well as the taught, which I have already mentioned. I will not dwell on this for more time. I think that is sufficient. Critical thinking, both for the teachers and the taught. The fourth one is important, and I would request the Vice Chancellor is also present here. You have to involve the principals and the teachers once in a while, once in a year, in an exercise called as curriculum development. Otherwise, the teachers do not know what they are speaking, because you give the syllabus, right? You ask them to teach, they will teach the syllabus. You know, somebody used to say, have you covered the syllabus? A teacher who covers the syllabus is not a teacher. A teacher who uncovers the syllabus is a teacher. Right? I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. The teacher may not complete all the 10 units or 5 units, but whatever unit he or she completes, he has given transformative information, knowledge to the student body. You have to uncover the syllabus. But to uncover the syllabus, some syllabus is required. And that curriculum development is an art by itself. You bring the teachers for some time, right, in a panel discussion, and make one principal in charge of one particular subject, look into what the Bar Council has mentioned, and then what changes you would like to make in that curriculum, and you make the teachers get involved in that, right? Therefore, when they go back, they have the onerous task of inculcating what they have mentioned in the curriculum development in translating that information in the actual classroom, right? It will be much more easier. Otherwise, in the traditional system, which is very, very comfortable, somebody sets the syllabus. And when he sets the syllabus, he will prescribe a book which is available only in the Madras University, nowhere else. Right? Even the teacher will not get it if he's outside Madras. Right? And somebody teaches with that book or without that book, the way that he or she wants, they also teach. Somebody sets the question paper. Somebody evaluates. I've got too many anecdotes on this evaluation. I undertook central valuation only one time in Pachapas College. Right? That was the first day and the last day of my central evaluation. I refused to go after that because when I was struggling to complete 35 scripts in a day, 40 was given. Even at 6 o'clock, I was handling the 38th script. Right? Whereas my neighbor from the same college completed 140. And I wrote to the controller saying, this is the last time I won't come. I don't want to compete with people. And then I heard a lot many jokes, right? Sometimes, you know, a Christian college teacher who is from the north, he valued a paper written in Tamil, who was struggling to speak even in Tamil, right? The script was given, he also marked, because you know the range, 40 to 50 if you keep, nobody will question your evaluation, and you can correct even 200 scripts in a day because money is important, right? So therefore, then in that process, neither the curriculum development you are involved, examination you are not involved, evaluation you do your own, those things will not help you to mold yourself as a good teacher as you process, as you progress. And it cannot be done on your own. The institutions should also support it. And that is why I requested that at least once in a year, for that year, whatever subject is being taught, what are the electives, how many electives can be changed, right? In Madras Law College, when I was studying, they used to give optional subjects, right? And we have nicknamed it as compulsory optional, right? You have to take it. Though it's called as electives, yeah, that is, no other elective is given. Elective is where two or more courses are given and a student is given the opportunity to choose one of them. And that was not prevailing. And you need to look at it, right? Evolve method through which limited options you can give, develop, and the years to come, you can give more and more options, right? Otherwise, you know, you think depending upon the availability of teachers, you cannot even manage this. No, but there are other problems. That is why I said institutional support should also be forthcoming. This will give you periodic revision so that you update your syllabus and make the teachers also understand that updated information is given. And even when they go to the class, if there is some additional information is coming, for example, when you draft the constitution, constitutional law course, and when you do it 104th amendment, but when you go back to the class, it may be 107 amendments that have already been passed. You cannot still say syllabus is saying only 104th, I will not go beyond. So therefore, consciously you are making the students, I'm sorry, the teachers, get involved in the curriculum planning and development, and they will also imbibe those qualities when they go back for teaching. The fifth one is integrating information. This is very, very crucial for a teacher, which seldom we do. The law schools are law schools because of this. That is the only difference I can see. Otherwise, there are very many good teachers in the traditional law colleges, sometimes even better than the law school teachers, right? But what makes the law school a law school is because of this, the fifth proposition, integrating information, legal or otherwise, with the curriculum. What do you do that? And how do you do that? The teacher is given the job of preparing the teaching plan. So in a semester, how many days, working days are there? The calendar is printed and circulated. So you have to print, prepare a calendar, right? If you have 90 working days, how we are going to divide the topics in, arrange it in 90 different lectures, right? Day, what topic you want to cover? What is the reading material you are referring to? From a particular book, these many pages, an article given, a website given, a judgment of the Supreme Court, whatever it is. You tell the students, out of 100, at least 20 will read and come. Right? Then I'll tell you what is the role of the teacher thereafter. If you don't give anything, nobody will read and come. But at least now 20 will read and come. Right? Why you are giving the teaching plan, the reading material, including the digital media, wherever it is available. We speak about Supreme Court. We have not even shown the photograph of the Supreme Court to the students. Right? We have been teaching about Income Tax Act, but we have not the students to even file the income tax returns, which is very simple. An 8th student, 8th standard student can do it. So now you can integrate that in the classroom and say, this is how the form looks like. This is how the Supreme Court looks like. The photograph of the Chief Justice. At least, you know, though they don't meet personally, you integrate that information, right? That is why I said including digital media. And then you say pedagogy of teaching, whether you are going alone or whether you are inviting some people for a special lecture on a particular topic which you don't understand. For example, initially, when we discussed about center-state relations and particularly on river water disputes, I had to bring the chief engineer, public works department, to tell us what is meant by average rainfall, what is meant by cubic feet, what is meant by this, area in which the rainfall is captured. You know, all these things, storage level, dead storage, right, wastage on the way. Oh my God, things which we don't know, but we keep on speaking about the Supreme Court judgment, right? But when you understand all these things, your way of looking at it is entirely different. And when you translate it, there were 7 different teachers when we discussed about Cauvery water disputes, the chief engineer of PWD, right? The former Chief Justice Venkatramaya, 3 teachers of the law school, right? 1 lawyer who has argued the case, Cauvery disputes case in Delhi. All these 7 teachers were there, and we discussed only the river water disputes for 7 days, only on that topic. I realized when I was a student in Madras Law College, the entire center-state relations was discussed in 1 week. And 1 week means only 3 days. Alternate days we used to have the classes. 6 hours, everything was over, right? At the first year level, we are giving all these details and you see the change that I can see among the students today, right? So therefore, all the details you have to bring in that adds to the pedagogy, and that leads to the creation of an academic environment, right? I don't boast of saying, I know what is meant by average rainfall. I may read something, I may still understand something, but nothing like an expert coming and telling how it is measured, what it means, right? How it is having an implication on the river water sharing, how the court has to take this into consideration. All these things will come in because of that academic environment that we have created, not only for teaching, but for teaching learning exercise. The sixth one, how much time I have, Dr. Gauri?
You still have time, sir.
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Okay. You can continue, sir.
Right. The sixth one is evaluation, right? I don't have to say much about the scenario in Tamil Nadu because I have firsthand seen what it is. But we increased the atmosphere for evaluation to some extent, right? At least some of the principals will understand that we have provided. Vincent Kamaraj was very, very observant. He used to come and say, sir, at least we should give them some snacks to eat in the evening, in the morning, tea breaks, lunch, transporting them from the place of residence because we did not have the facility, right? But it is not out of turn. It is the money that we have collected. We have spent it on the teachers as well. So they were willing to come, right? That atmosphere needs to be maintained so that the teachers are not as machines to evaluate. And if you allow them to be machines, then possibly the type of evaluation that I mentioned will also come in, right? And I was an inquiry officer for the Madras University, right? A political science teacher in the central evaluation from Pachapas College has evaluated English literature papers. Not one or two, one full bundle, 120 papers or so. And he appeared before me, he was my colleague. And I asked him, how did you manage to do this? The professor, I mentioned somewhere I read the Herbert Spencer. I don't know, in all the 120 scripts, Herbert Spencer was the theme. And then I decided I have to give them marks and I passed all of them, right? So anything is possible. So when they are mechanical, this is the outcome, right? And when the outcome is like this, let me tell you, the impact on the learning process becomes even more difficult. People will think, okay, I can without reading, go and take the exam. Anyhow, I'll pass, right? That attitude, if it creeps in, any amount of revolution that you bring in from above will not reach the students who are our consumers, right? So you can understand the impact on this process. So there are lots of things. If you are a teacher, little techno-savvy, in the classroom, I've tested this, that's what I'm saying. When I went back to law school for a brief period to teach from Ambedkar Law University, the fourth year batch was becoming a very vociferous batch in law school. 80 students, they were not respecting the teachers because whatever is the reason. And then the vice chancellor asked me, would you like to go to the class? 1 week the teacher is off. Can you step in? I said, why not? And I did not meet them in the first year, second year, or third year. I was straight away going to the fourth year. I went to the class. I brought what you call it as the PowerPoint presentation, made them work, raised some questions. I was walking up and down, right, looking at what the students, you know, in the name of using computers, they are using their emails and others. They were not listening to or taking notes, right? Jovially, I put them, make them realize that they are doing something wrong. 1 week, I told them that I'm going to give a test, an online test, right? And then I was trained there in Singapore on this. So I used this, it's called as Kahoot.com. It's a game, right? Let me tell you, when I started doing this in 2014, the 80 students who were sitting in the last bench, in 1 week, they all came to the front row. Front rows were jam-packed because instead of telling, don't use the mobile phone, now I tell them for testing, use the mobile phone, use the laptop, right? And then immediately the score comes and they can see on the screen who is leading. You know, they used to give their nicknames, right? Make fun of, join them. You know, it was such a hilarious exercise. At the fag end, they wrote to the vice chancellor stating, this is how the classes are to be taught and evaluated. 1 week exercise, right? So you can bring change in a much more meaningful manner, right? Using technology, it is possible, right? What was incorrigible batch of students, right? Became corrigible students, right? Why? Because we are able to think, mold, implement, and see how it comes out successfully. Therefore, every teacher must be given that freedom to use this and start with multiple choice question in the classroom. Don't give multiple choice question paper in the examination, because students are students. When I was invigilating in the Presidency College, Madras, the objective questions were given, right? 10 minutes pin drop silence, 15 minutes pin drop silence, 20 minutes, because half an hour they have to complete 30 questions, answers, and give it that one sheet to the examiner. 22nd minute, somebody comes, you know, the big English lecture hall, as you travel through the Presidency College and facing the beach, it's a huge lecture hall. There will be somebody with the microphone, public address system, wireless. My name is so-and-so, contesting for the president's election or the secretary's election. These are the answers. Question number A, answer is C. The last 8 minutes you will see, everyone, pin drop silence, but everyone is answering the question, right? When I saw this, I wrote a letter, a strong letter to the controller of exams, Madras University, saying that this must be eliminated from the process of examination. It is worse than a tamasha, right? But in a classroom exercise, that is the most meaningful, best, because you involve the students. That's, you know, the purpose is different. Evaluation for marks is different. Evaluation for understanding in the classroom is something different. So if you are able to put these two things together, I think you can still make then descriptive paper setting in traditional universities. I have also seen in Ambedkar Law universities. What are the powers and functions of the president? Right? If you master 3 years question paper, you will not fail. On the contrary, if you give a problem-based question and tell that examination will be conducted at the library, you can refer to any book you want. Right? Then you see the change, right? So if you want to conduct the examination, once again, for the controller of examination and the vice chancellor present here, for constitutional law course examination, why don't you supply the text of the Indian Constitution without notes? Because I don't think any teacher has mugged up all the 395 provisions, right? And why do you expect the students to do it? And you say in the examination, you will give them the text of the Constitution and collect it back after the exam is over. So each and every college, you know the number, how many students will come, whether it is IPC, CPC, CRPC, any act, give the bare act. If the act is not available with the comments, you can print your own, bite them, keep them. Slowly inculcate that ability to depend on the text and writing it critically, rather than memorizing and writing it. Tell me which judge knows everything by heart? Which lawyer knows everything by heart? But why do we expect that these students know everything by heart? And that is a place where, when we transmit that information and evaluate them, we thoroughly fail. Therefore, our approach needs to change a little to create that academic environment that I have been mentioning, right? Create a moot court immediately in the classroom, not necessarily how to make them. Or give a point and say, how many of you oppose it? How many of you propose it? What changes you want to bring? Ask the students to propose. One or two hesitants will be there, but slowly but steadily they will understand. They start speaking openly in the classroom. involve the students in that. And then after the exam is over, if you give the model answer, right, upload it on the website, let me tell you, there won't be any revaluation available to you. Because the teacher has set the paper, evaluated, the teacher has given the model answer, and anyone valuing the papers also will keep that model answer in evaluation. And therefore, the student, the moment he completes the exam, right, in the CLAT examination, all of you would appreciate, right? The moment the exam is over, we were the first ones to do it, right? We upload the question paper and we upload the key also. So even before the announcement of the results, the students will calculate how many answers, right answers they have ticked and how many wrong answers they have ticked. Right? Transparency, openness, they don't doubt you. So therefore, these are the small changes that you can bring in the teaching learning process. And the teacher is the anchor for everything. It is not the administration. The teacher is the anchor, right? And the FDP should train the teachers in doing all these things openly, and how to prepare a problem-based question, right? And how to evaluate it, how to create, you know, all these things need to be trained. Otherwise, you know, very jovially, I was talking to the chairman UGC. He enjoyed this joke, you know, very thoroughly. I was telling the sir, what is the status of this net? What is meant by net? He said, you don't know, you're a vice chancellor. No, sir, I know. I just wanted to know from you. He said, national eligibility test. Right, sir, that is what you are doing it because you're sitting in UGC. As teachers and as educational administrators outside, if you ask me, we also expand it, abbreviate it as not eligible to teach. Right? It is the same, but with the way that we look at it, not eligible to teach. Because there are many people who are coming with net qualification. They cannot open their mouth in the classroom. They can't speak a word. Right? So therefore, the onus is on these FDPs in making them open their mouth and then think critically and open their mouth more frequently in the classroom. And that is the contribution the FDP can do it. Maintenance of records, right? The teachers, you know, internal assessment marks and other things, changing at the behest of somebody else, other considerations, these must be minimized. You have to keep in mind. The eighth one is about research publication. Today, if some of the judges of the Supreme Court refer to an article that I published in, Oxford University Journal, right, on refugees, it is because of that writing, right? You are known without looking at who Vijay Kumar is, how he would look like. They look at the article that you have published and through that you are known. And I would appreciate if the teachers are known through their publications. It is not a punishment. It is self-elevating exercise. If you start writing, after 10 articles, you will see your art of writing would have, you know, enhanced manifold. If you don't write anything, nothing will improve. That's a different story. But if you start writing, sending it to various journals, and then they also assist you, I think over a period of time, you will be known for your work in a particular area. And let me tell you, that is how your invitation comes from outside, right? When I told you I traveled to 40 countries, it is because of my association, right? The moment you go and make an impression somewhere, they say, okay, this is the guy who is able to deliver some goods. So there, out of 100 participants, at least 30 of them call you to three different places or 30 different places. So your network increases, and I would appreciate every teacher, right? I would even consider the vice chancellor and the director of legal studies to impose a rule, right? Not that you have to be attentive, punctual, that is routine, right? You have to engage your classes. But if you say your annual increment will be available only on successful completion of two publications in a year, mandatory, right? Apart from teaching, two publications is not at all a Herculean task for the teachers, right? So some sort of force from above, some involvement from the teachers can also take the institution to greater heights. Please don't curse me for telling this, because in the teachers training program, I should not make you feel bad, but I think you will realize the benefits maybe after you complete your 10th article. There was something in which, you know, some truth lies in whatever I said. It's not as a penal clause, but it is an enabling clause where everyone can be compelled to do what he or she is expected to do. Then I already mentioned about ICT. It has changed thoroughly. It is no more ICT, video lecturing, because the fear that I am being recorded, right? So I come prepared. I cannot come and blabber without any, keep on telling some stories about what I have done, what I have achieved, right? But I have to modulate my presentation in a particular format. So I need to prepare, right? So therefore, use of ICT has graduated, in manifold dimensions, and even interactions are becoming increasingly possible, right? So please try to understand. And recently we had, I was in a high power committee organized by the Bar Council of India. The committee was headed by the former Chief Justice of Allahabad High Court. It is about universities conducting examination, right? For the students of law during the pandemic, right? Some universities said they canceled all the exams. Somebody said previous year's average will give. I don't know how you secured in CPC will hold good for CRPC. Have you scored in constitutional law can hold good for international law? I don't know, right? So everyone followed something, and the Bar Council issued a notification, and many people went to the court. And then today everyone can approach the court because we are a free country, right? For anything we can go to the Supreme Court. And I went to the Supreme Court also last year in 2020. The Supreme Court said two important points very clearly. Examination is mandatory, we will not interfere. Number two, what should be the process of evaluation? We leave it to the individual universities, we are not experts, right? So in the committee meeting, we discussed and said, it is best left to the teachers themselves, the universities themselves. So you plan something, and whatever you say, the Bar Council will not oppose you. So use ICT methods, whatever it is, it's all online examination, online open book examination. All these things are possible, right? So we need to live according to the developments and the scenario in which we are living. And finally, the last proposition is that the UGC has constantly, in the last 10 years, has been promoting something called as Swayam and MOOCs, right? Massive online courses, right? Open online courses. And it has got too many courses available on its website, Swayam portal. The UGC has also, once again, for the Director of Legal Studies and the Vice Chancellor, right? The UGC last year sent a circular stating you can integrate, move your academic council, executive council, and get the approval that 20% of the courses can be done through these courses. It is not mandatory, it is voluntary. The student has to come forward and say, I'm going to enroll for this MOOCs program. So if you have 6 courses in a semester or 5 courses in a semester, 2 courses you can easily take online, right? It did not come to your classes. At the fag end, he will bring a certificate and an evaluated certificate. He has got this many marks or grade. Then you can integrate that into, so for which academic council regulation is required to be appreciated and approved by the executive council and by all university bodies, right? So that you are taking away the pressure of teaching through this online. I told you it is going to be a sort of a blended mode of teaching. So 20% of the courses, not many people will take, because nothing like physical teaching learning experience. But still, some interested student may do it, right? And now, this year, by March 2021, the same UGC has mentioned that instead of 20% of the courses, it can be 40% of the courses. Have you integrated? So I would request both of you to look at, I'm not saying that you must hurry, but put everything in organized form and encourage those 20% of smart students in each and every class to avail the benefits of this, right? And once they start doing it, the remaining 60% will follow. 20% will not follow, it's all right, you teach, right? So therefore, for the transition to take place, this online portal must be relied upon. They're all free. And even the FDPs are conducted online. it is not necessary that you have to undergo physical 3 weeks program. Online programs are equal, and if you prepare one MOOCs program, it is equivalent to an FDP program. I think they have come out with lot many incentives, right? So why don't you do it in Tamil? Nothing wrong in it, right? And develop those courses, develop that atmosphere, and automatically you also learn, and you will also make the learners understand what you have in store for you. Having said all these things, I can keep on speaking for hours together on this. The concluding observation will be on two things. One is, I made a mention about academic environment, right? What is this academic environment? The academic environment is not born or created, but it must be consciously built over a period of time, because there are three major players in that, equally important. No one is superior, no one is inferior. And only when these three participants come together, three players come together, a proper academic environment can be created for an effective and meaningful teaching learning process. Who are they? The first one is the institution itself. You talk about blended mode of teaching, ICT, AO, then finally the institution is not even having an internet connection. How will it take place? Right? So therefore, how the facilities, the equipments, subscription, periodic subscription to online databases, right? Free databases, all these things must be brought by the institution to the benefit of the teachers as well as the taught. That is the first one. What I would put it as, infrastructural facilities, extending all infrastructural facilities and support mechanism to the other two players to create the academic environment. That's number one. The second one is teachers, right? The teachers have 1/3 of the role in building the academic environment, right? If you are honest, sincere, dedicated, committed, right, up to the mark, let me tell you, the teachers will follow you like a kitten. If you are good, they are obedient. If you are good in your behavior, concerned about their welfare, right? I still remember when the Sri Lankan affair, the students of Ambedkar Law University also went on a strike. Sandra Pandian was still the director, I think. I don't remember, right? And the students all went in front of the campus and blocked the road. Then I told Sandra Pandian, I would like to go and meet the students. He said, no, sir, you are vice chancellor. You are not supposed to go to the street. We'll manage, right? But I think you command respect when you go to the ground zero, right? And face the situation. What will happen, right? And then, you know, by seeing my presence there, some students vanished, some of them still, but ultimately when they agreed to withdraw, that I think Sandra Pandian will tell the story that the people who were behind that strike, they were signaling him not to go, right? But still, when you go and sit in ground zero and talk to the students that they are causing infringement of the rights of the people, of their movement, so on and so forth, they were vulnerable. They are willing to accept it, right? So the teacher must, the role is not only in the classroom, but to control, to regulate, facilitate. That's why I told you, the teacher is everything, right? You have your own personal life, but in your official life, you have to spend 2/3 of your time, right? Or at least 1/3, 8 hours that you have to give, 1/3 you must be constantly indulging in multifarious activities. That is the role of a quality teaching. And teaching means teaching, research, and publication all put together, right? That is the role of a teacher. The third participant is the students themselves, right? That inculcating the students to understand their role in the creation of this academic environment, at the beginning of every year, repeatedly they must be inculcated with certain values, You have paid the fees. You have come here to learn, and therefore don't disturb this understanding. Right? Repeatedly, you have to tell, involve them, and over a period of time, you will see changes taking place in your own institutions. So these three can come together, create what you call it as the academic environment. And I will not get into the other details, maybe on some other occasion, how to improve the quality of teaching, so on and so forth. I will reserve it for some other occasion. Now, coming to a couple of things. Because of the COVID, these 4 points as concluding remarks, the impact of COVID had made many of the publishers, many of the libraries, to make the digitization that I referred to earlier. They have digitized and they are allowing it to be accessed by anyone. Earlier, it was limited to only members. They are now allowing it to everyone. It is open to everyone. And we need to translate this to the reference of the students and the teachers so that the books, periodicals, everything is available online, free of cost. And this 20% will certainly become 40% and 60 to 80% over a period of time. Right? They're all available. So I will not get into the number of URLs that you have to note down and give it to the students. Second thing is, as we are all law teachers, when I was in Ambedkar Law University, I also became a partner along with 6 other law schools to create an open access legal database. It is called as Legal Information Institute of India, right? And if you just propagate this to the students in the very first orientation class, that if you go to this www.liiofindia.org, there are 158 databases of India available round the clock, free of cost. What is required is an instrument, a mobile phone or a laptop or a computer and your internet access. That's all. All the Supreme Court decisions from 1950 to present, right? All the High Court decisions, tribunals decisions, the statutes, the constitution, everything is available free of cost, right? So in the orientation program, in the first day, the principals tell the students, at least read one judgment a day. But if you ask them to read Keshavanta Bharati, they will never read the judgment again, right? You identify 3-4 pages, 10 pages, 15 pages, ask them to read a judgment a day, their vocabulary will improve and they will also involve themselves in participation in the classroom, right? And this platform will help you to a great extent. The second or the third one that I would like to mention, which I already mentioned, is about the Kahoot. Kahoot is not the only platform. Google also has the platform, but the gaming platform, they are available in plenty today. Microsoft also has. Right, you choose whatever you are comfortable with and use that at least weekly once in the classroom. Right, you will see the enthusiasm of the students coming to the classroom, whether they are answering the question rightly or wrongly, but the way they participate, enjoy the fun, right? I think that is the way that we need to take this forward, and Kahoot is only such an example. The last one is, there is also one more website called as pdffiles.org, pdffiles.org. There are more than 3.5 million books of all the subjects, including law, public policy, health, internet, cyber crimes, you call it human rights. 3.5 million books are available free of cost, which you can download and ask the students, and let us inculcate the practice of reading the relevant books, classics, and then we can translate them into Tamil or any other language that we may teach. And these things will possibly take you from what you are to somewhat a better position in which you will also enjoy being a teacher, right? I thoroughly enjoy as a teacher rather than sitting as a registrar or as a vice chancellor, right? I always enjoy teaching, particularly in an open class, where you would be questioned and you have to answer, right? Nothing like teaching. And I hope all of you will imbibe that quality and improve yourselves. Listen to all the resource persons carefully, because everyone has something or the other to give, right? And you should have an open mind in learning whatever little you can learn and implement it in your practice, and thereby elevating yourselves, right? Within the academic environment provided by the Vice Chancellor or by the Director of Legal Studies, because they're all bound by the rules and regulations. You can't blame them. I understand that. But I think constantly they can also get the support, and they can certainly improve, right, in the years to come. Thank you very much for listening to me patiently. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. We just have one interesting question, with your permission, if I may ask.
Please, please.
The question is, your suggestions on coaching slow learners or persons with learning disability.
Yeah. Yeah, this is what I mentioned when I, you know, a teacher, it's a good question. I'm sorry, I have not. That is why I said, on some other occasion, I may come in and tell you how effective you should be a teacher. When you just go to the class, right, in the first few classes, not in the very first class, it may take few classes for you to assess the entire section, maybe 100 students in your class or 80 students in your class. I think with the Bar Council coming into picture, 60 students in a class, right? Out of 60 students in a class, and sometimes in the colleges, you know, the one teacher is always absent. So it may be 120. That is why I said 120, 60 to 120 can be the number. But in the first few days, you can easily assess the class. At the back of your mind, you continue to teach, but simultaneously you assess the class and find out that you can easily divide the class under three broad categories. Students who are interested, who have come with the purpose of learning something. That is around 30%, maximum of 30%. If it is more than 30%, you are lucky, right? So purpose, the students who are coming there with the purpose of learning in each and every class is around 30%. It is always not static. It is always fluid. Tomorrow, you know, something happens at my place, I may not be a good listener, right? So I have not come there to listen. My purpose is different. I met with an accident, you know.
So your voice is breaking, sir, I think. Bandwidth issue.
Dear participants, please wait. There is a technical glitch has happened, so please wait. Thank you.
Power issue, ma'am. I think he got disconnected. Uh-huh. Waiting for him to come back. Yeah, sir is back now.
Okay.
There is some disruption.
I'm sorry.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You're audible, sir.
Yeah. So the second batch of students, one third, they are like cat on the wall. It is the knack of the students to make them jump on the right side or on the wrong side, right? But there will be like cat on the wall. The last one third, I won't say one third, I told you 80% of the students you can really convert. 20% of the students, they are not interested at all. Now, a teacher is not a magician to change all of them overnight, right? A teacher, and that is why I said you have to assess your floor the first 10 days, identify the good learners, fast learners, who are taking whatever you are saying, right? And also take the other one third right? Are 30 to 40% of the students who are like cat on the wall. You have to constantly engage them more than the first batch. First batch is following, but your engagement must be with the second batch of 30 to 40% like cat on the wall, because the onerous task is to make them jump to the right side. And then by the end of the semester, if you have around 60 to 65% of the students who are listeners, you are a good teacher, right? Then how do you convert this remaining 20% into good students? That is a place where the teacher can make a change, because if you do complete the semester, the 20% is not convinced because they have not learned anything, but they have followed one thing. And their juniors, when they interact with them, they will say, yes, this teacher is very good. See what I'm trying to tell you. That is part of the environment. The students will tell the juniors because they interact with them more meaningfully than what you and I do in the classroom. So they will tell, oh, this class, you must be very careful. This class, please go and attend. Then I didn't appreciate it. Only when I took the exam, I realized, please attend to this class. Those people will convert them over a period of time. And that is going on a chain year after year. And that is why I told you the teacher is continuously evaluated by the students. And that 20% you are able to convince through these indirect methods, you have created a wonderful academic environment in the campus, in your classroom, right? And then let me tell you, the counseling, I told you, even among the 20% you identify, some of them are not able to do it, right? And when we call them and tell them, ask them, some of them give the sad story. Sir, my father passed away. I am constantly thinking how to continue this education. I don't have the money. So immediately we try to push the management to, you know, waive the fees, give them scholarships, give the hostel fees, so on and so forth. So that counseling part of it, you can also still convert the 20% into the mainstream learners. It is an art by itself, right? It is not acquired over a period of overnight. It has to be acquired over a period of time. And that is why when Upendra Bakshi goes to deliver a lecture, even the 20% who has not attended his classes when he was teaching in the Delhi University would go and stand there for 2 hours and listen to him, right? That is the remarkable achievement of a teacher. And that is also equally remarkable achievement of those 20% of the learners, right? Who realize their mistake and they don't want to leave anything per chance anymore. And that respect you have to come, right? So that is an art, and that is what the entire higher education system also trains us, tells us, you have to spot the slow learners. And for slow learners, you have to organize tutorials. And let me tell you, you catch hold of these 30% of the students who are good, maybe senior students, and ask them to teach this remaining 30 to 40% or the 20% in the evenings in their own language. Let me tell you, what you communicate to the student as a teacher-learner relation, a learner-learner relation, they will learn better. And that type of tutorial can also yield lots of results as you proceed, right? But you are doing it consciously, but you are using the students themselves, right? The students will tutor them, students will teach them. I think that will be amazing. That will be amazing.
Thank you very much, sir.
Right?
That's so inspiring. I hand over the session to Professor Dr. Gauri Ramesh for the vote of thanks.
Thank you. Thank
you. If you have any other question, I'll be too happy to respond.
Almost all the questions you've answered, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Hepsi. Good afternoon to one and all present here. I extend my heartfelt thanks to Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Vijayakumar sir for his thought-provoking session in driving home the point regarding the essential ingredients of becoming an acclaimed law teacher and the role of a law teacher in the 21st century. At this juncture, sir, I would like to second your reference to Professor M. Soundarapandian sir and Professor Vincent Kamrad sir as role models, true role models of Madras Law College students, sir. So your emphasis about the importance of constitutional law, jurisprudence, and the mastering of technology will definitely be well taken by our participants. And I assure you, sir, that the three main points of Harvard School mentioned by you will be the three commandments for our participants in their teaching career. I am also sure, sir, that our participants will strive to become good tutors, counselors, and role models for their students following your prescription and transform into anchors by the time of this FPP completion. I thank you once again, sir, for accepting our invite and enlightening our participants with your engaging and enriching sessions, sir. Thank you once again, sir. And I thank all the esteemed dignitaries for gracing the technical session also amidst their busy schedule. Thank you, one and all present here, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
Thanks.
You, sir. Thank you.
Good day. Good day to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Nandri vanakkam.
Nandri vanakkam, sir.
Vanakkam.
Thank you,
sir. Sir, thank you, sir. Sir, VC, sir, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Unmute pannunga, sir.
Sir, unmute. Ma, Shyam, unmute
pannunga. Or unmute pannunga, sir. Sir, நீங்க அன்மியூட் பண்ணலாம் சார் வின்சென்ட் சார் என்ன சார் பேசலாம் வின்சென்ட் சார் அன்மியூட் பண்ணிக்கலாம் சார் நீங்க வீடியோ
சார் எம்எஸ் சார் थैंक यू சார் थैंक यू so much for
thank you madam
sir and encouraging us
all the best sir
thank you very much sir thank you
வின்சென்ட் சார் இப்ப பேசலாம் சார்
சார் வின்சென்ட் சார் thank you sir
thank you very much madam thank you very much very enlightening session I am much enriched to because of
thank you so much sir for encouragement sir
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Dear participant, please wait. There is an announcement to be made out.
Dear participants, kindly fill the feedback form. It is very important for your attendance. As we have already mentioned, 80% of attendance is mandatory. So kindly fill the feedback form and join us back at 2:00 exactly. We have the second speaker coming in.
Announcement. So you can announce that there is no mail hereafter come, only in the Telegram group.
Yes, please. Telegram is mandatory. Kindly join the Telegram group. Those who have not joined yet, please join the Telegram group. Sending out mails is very difficult, so I hope you all will cooperate with us for the 7 days to come. Yeah,
only those who are having the registered number, please mention that. Apart from not registered members, don't use the form. Only we have given the registered form only. Registered members should fill the form.
You may have to memorize your registration number and keep it for the next 7 days. It will be handy for you. So once you filled your feedback form, you can leave for now and rejoin at 2:00. The link for the Zoom platform will be shared with you in Telegram group.
Already shared, na?
It's already shared. Yeah, it's already shared. The work has been done by the technical team, so you can proceed. Have a good lunch and join back at 2:00. Thanks for joining.
Thank you, Hepsi. Thank you, Ramya. Thank you, Kritika. Thank you, Shyam.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you,
Devi.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Ashwati, I shared you the link. So everyone is making the
thing.
Already we got the received the feedback from everyone. So please fill this form. Within 10 minutes only, we'll close it. Within 10 minutes, we'll close the form. So please fill the form as soon as possible.